Too early.
What the?
You guys holding up?
Hey, Brandon, what's on your finger?
What the fuck is that?
What the hell did this happen?
Oh, great. It's the hangover. Pretty woman walking down the street. Pretty woman, the kind I like to meet. Pretty woman, ooh.
I don't believe you. We are not the truth.
Hey!
No one could look as good as you.
Mercy. Pretty woman, won't you pardon me?
I'm just kidding, guys. This is just the Ring of Mordor. I'm not married.
Well, unless there's some lady viewers out there who are single, Brandon right here is available.
Oh, we all are, so this goes out to all of us. How's it going on YouTube? My name's a Darker Viewer. Welcome back to our top 10 videos. Wow, man. Jumping right into a video after we had a war with each other.
And now
I won that.
And we're going to jump into a bigger one.
We lost three people.
No, Trey, nobody won four.
Let us pay tribute to our three fallen, Jessica, Philip, and dear old Jolly Saint Nick. Let us take a moment of silence for them.
Moment of silence. Okay, I'm done.
Okay, yeah.
But anyways, guys, we had so much fun with that one. And this one might even get even more exciting. Because you all know how we did a part one of anime waifus, as you know of. So, why not do it again? Because we divorced everyone from that list. Time to pick some new waifus in this one. Guys, here we are. We are going to give you the part two of the anime waifu wars.
This is going to be bad.
I got us all dates.
True. So anyways, here's how the list is going. I will actually go ahead and kick things off first this time around. Nice. I'll bring it back full circle.
Nice.
And going to second, we were actually going to you, Kev. You're going.
Hi.
And then I'm going down to best boy Trey at number three.
You're bronze medal.
But
Nate, my good boy, you're going to number four.
Oh, I called you the good boy.
Eric, dormant Eric, you're at number five.
I can live with that.
Of course. Of course.
Indeed, ADA. Best for last, my friend.
In this case.
I wouldn't say not.
Also, mind if I give a minor disclaimer real quick?
No.
Go ahead.
Yes.
Keep in mind that even though half these girls may be underage, none of us are pedophiles.
Okay, you know what? He's not wrong.
Not wrong.
Oh, wow. That's coming from the same guy who has Misaka, who is like younger than you, Kev, in the last video.
Or basically Eric, who chose Ravel in the Smash Mary kill list.
Yeah, that's right!
Oh, damn.
Either way, let's go ahead and get this war one more time going through. We are going off to our number 10s.
Oh boy.
So number 10, we all know that the sword is a perfect weapon, but a shield is the best defense.
What?
So for my number 10, I'm going with Maple from Booty Footy, that I didn't want to get her, so I put all my points in defense, but I tied her with someone who I really love this spin-off of the Fate series. It is Mash Pure Light, or Shielder, from Fate Grand Order Babylonia.
Ooh. Why does it keep freezing on me?
So, what can I say about Maple? She's just adorable, okay? I am dead serious. She's just an adorable character. Plus, she's an OP character as well. That alone just is adorable when she uses her skills, but absolutely terrifying if you face it, if you're her opponent. I mean, literally, she has Predator, she has Hydra, she has holy. She has the holy angel. She has the. She has a mecha. She has a mech armor, and she can transform into a demon. Just holy hell! And she. All she does is a shield. That's her main, like, weapon is a shield, and she is. Because, like, the whole, like, the way she maxed out all of her defense, all she does is max out defense. So she's basically invulnerable to a certain degree. And I just really like the story and how she's just there to have fun. And it's just adorable when she finds out, like, certain things are just cute to her. And just when her friends see it, she's just like, I can't believe she unlocked another skill. I cannot wait. We are supposed to be getting season 2. I really hope that happens. Let's move off to MASH, or Shielder. Now, Shielder from Fate Grand Order. Like I said before, the sword may be the mightiest of weapons, but her shield can just knock the hell out of you. She is so agile. She is so deadly with this weapon. And it's mostly used for defense. She would give even Captain America a run for his money with this thing.
Even, and now for me too.
Maybe, if they ever put that in a death battle, I would watch it. Maybe. But it's just that she is just so kawaii, and I love her for it. She just has so many cute, adorable moments, especially in Fate Grand in Grand Order Babylonia. I saw a scene when she's eating breakfast, and she just has that. Just a little look in her eye. I'm just like, ew. So even though a sword may be the ideal weapon for people, these two ladies know how to rock a shield for their primary weapon. And that's kicking off my number 10.
Wow. Hey, that's a strong defense.
Yes, it is.
Best defense, best offense.
So, Kevin, do you have any good offense for your number 10?
Oh.
Tell me something. What if you're walking down the street and a dragon suddenly appears, starts wreaking havoc? Who are you going to call? A witch. And there is no witch I would want protecting me more than Noelle Nihashi from Burn.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. God. I know. Look. This may only have 3 episodes, but Burn the Witch just gives you 2 waifus, but one of them is obviously superior. I'm sorry, Nini, but Noelle is better. Because,
amen, brother.
Because, okay, this girl, you know how heroes are typically like, we'll just do a job to save people? No, she does a job to get money. She'll even do a job by herself. She'll hunt dragons and even steal items just to sell them. It's fucking hilarious. And she's so stoic, but there's some times where you see her like being teasing, like when she's teasing Nini for the flower, or kicking Balco for trying to look at her panties. I mean, like, this girl is, and her roast, when she told Bruno, that's a terrible hair dye job, he's like, what? It's like, she's, what, Trey?
Kevin, mention her ringtone.
Oh, no. Okay, wait, I'll get to that, but let me tell her powers. The ability to shoot a stun ball, to shoot light swords, to create a kind of curtain-like cage, and she rides a dragon? That's awesome! And even without her wand, dudes, she can kick a dragon, okay? She's human. And she can kick a dragon. That's awesome. Okay? And yes, Trey, here let me tell you guys.
Wait, is that dragon?
Let me tell you something. She is like us. She's a weeb. She loves everything about Japan. And she has the Dragon Ball theme song as her ringtone.
Yes.
That is hilarious.
Wait. So isn't this a series made by Bleach or something?
Yes. Yes, Taikubo. Okay, so the only reason she's like this low is because Burn the Witch only has 3 episodes. Well, we're getting season 2 soon. I need to read the manga first because god damn it, Kubo. Your interest, yes. The hype is coming. So Noelle is taking number 10.
Alrighty, nice. Go ahead, Trey. For your first waifu list, let's kick off yours.
Okay. Now, I'm going to start off with a medic character.
What?
Specifically a medic who always greets you with a kind smile.
Sakura.
Even though she's probably plotting stabbing her scalpels into your eyes.
Every time you
complain about your medicine.
Wish.
My number 10 is Shinobu Kocho from Demon Slayer.
Oh my god. Okay. I'm not gonna lie. I thought it was Yoshino. I thought it was Yoshino from Bugo Stray Dogs for a minute.
Fuck no.
The minute he said medic, I guessed.
Okay, go ahead, Trey.
Shinobu, and this is probably just ufotable with their amazing animation, her fighting style, when she killed that demon in the woods, it mesmerized me. I just couldn't look away from the screen. I was like, this is best girl. This is immediately best girl of the show. Fuck you, Nezuko. I love this chick. But in all seriousness, though, I like Shinobu because, like, she seems kind of real in a sense. Like, you know, like she comforts Tanjiro. Shit, she comforts Tanjiro about his dream of bringing Nezuko, turning Nezuko into a human. Like how some demons may still have humanity in them, similar to how her sister's dream of befriending demons one day. And while she doesn't believe it, she at least still respects it out of the memory of her dead sister. And I like how she acknowledges her own flaws, you know, how like she's putting on a fake smile, how she's holding in all this anger and resentment that she's carrying, but she's still trying to dish out some kindness like her role model did, you know, taking care of Kanao, you know, serving as a voice of wisdom, taking over the Butterfly Mansion, all that is respectable. And what goes on later in the manga, though, oh my god, it's fucking amazing. I'm not gonna spoil it, EDA, but oh my god, she is forever cemented in my heart for it goes down eventually. And also, I like how fucking fast she is. Like, holy shit, like she is weak as shit, but damn, can she just, like, she's like freaking like Akame levels of fast. It's insane. I love it.
In the classic words, she floats like a butterfly, but she stings like a freaking wasp.
Yes.
So, I'm gonna go with murder point, but that works too.
Yes, number 10, the insect Hashira Shinobu Kochu.
Nice. You get a clap for me, Trey.
Better than Mitsuru, I will say that.
True.
Fuck you.
Go ahead, Nate. What do you got?
Okay, number 10. Well, are you guys ready to go into a new era?
Mother!
If it's about 2021, I'm going to say no.
Oh my god, that's ironic, because this anime came out the same year.
Yep. All the series may have like three best girls, only one sold it for me. Towa Higarashi.
From?
Okay, from?
Yashihime.
You never say it.
Yep.
We just had to have him say it.
Yeah. But yeah, like I said, all three girls are just great, but Toa for some reason just sold it for me. And I'm not gonna lie, and this is kind of embarrassing to admit, I thought Toa was a boy when I first started the series.
Literally, from boys, it almost sounds a bit...
Manly.
Well, not alone.
Dumb. It wasn't until, like, it was either, like, Setsuna or Maruha said, hey, want to come with us? And then she just said a girl. I was like, oh, what?
Well, I think that was her adopted sister that said, like,
oh, yeah,
did you want to dress in more feminine?
Yeah.
I mean, to be fair, they're cross-dressers, so.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. I mean, I think that also leads to it. Like, Toa, she wants to dress a bit feminine, but she prefers wearing boy clothing because it just makes her feel comfortable. And I could definitely understand it, like, wearing something that you prefer wearing because why the hell not? And I also love how, despite her being a bit reckless, she has a sense of justice. And that really comes after spending time in the modern era. which, by the way, Soda is best dad in that show.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Little annoying piece of shit got smart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, history can do that to a person. But the one thing that I really like about Toa is, despite being a tomboy, she does have her cute moments, and she definitely had some badass moments. Even though she may not be perfect, her demon powers, she's pretty good with it. Especially summoning that freaking dragon with the sword. I was
The blue crimson wave. And that was a cheap version. That wasn't the real deal.
I know. It makes me like excited and scared of what the real powerful version would look like.
Only time will tell that in the second part.
Yeah, but there are two reasons why Toa is only number 10. One, she's 14, so... And number two, again, Yashahime is still relatively new, but regardless, I still like Toa. She's badass. She's very kind. She's very sweet. And yeah, again, I have to say it. She's voiced by one of my favorite voice actors, and black hair Toa, my god.
I get behind that.
Hashtag Nate Sim. Then again, we are all Sims.
I was just about to say that, and not the first time I called a simp.
Alright. So, I'm not gonna beat around the bush with the intro. My number 10 is Hinata Hyuga from Naruto.
What? Wasn't she on your last list?
Oh, yeah!
Yeah.
Oh, well, let's learn.
To be fair, my lists are pretty narrow, and when it comes to chicks especially, my how do I describe it? I have my tastes are pretty narrowed down. if they don't meet a certain criteria, or there's even like one red flag, they're out.
Damn.
So Hinata Hyuga is an example of an anime chick who does not have that many red flags. Actually, she doesn't even have any red flags. She's literally the sweetest girl in the entire series.
You're a Sakura Ino.
even when, like, to be fair, Sakura and Ino were kind of really bitchy to Naruto, especially in the beginning.
No, you think so?
Hinata? Dude, everybody judged him for far less.
Yeah, it's true. Okay.
Hinata, on the other hand, not even close to judgmental. At all. She's like easily the friendliest girl you'll ever meet. And despite being very soft-spoken and polite, she actually does have a very tough side to her. I mean, just by the fact that she's a member of the Hyuga clan, for Christ's sake, I mean...
Have you seen what the Hyuga clan can do? I mean, even Hinata's daughter did...
Naruto's lucky to have her. He will never lose his TV remote. With her.
Yeah, exactly.
What a dumbass.
Exactly. And much like and Naruto has, of course, being the titular protagonist, might have time and time again and every opportunity to prove himself worthy as a ninja. Hinata, like a lot of the side characters in the entire series, does get a chance to prove herself in Shippuden when she tried to defend Naruto from Pain. Though she almost died doing so. Yeah. That just goes to show how determined she is. Against all odds.
There, yeah. But hey.
I was so pissed off when Naruto never talked to her after that. What the fuck?
Yeah. Yeah, what a bitch. She honestly was very underrated, frankly.
So, yeah.
For number 10, Hinata Hyuga.
Yeah, Eric.
Nice.
Also, she's got a nice rack. Do we forget to mention that? Okay, go ahead.
You have no self-control, do you?
Now, Eric, let's be real. Have I ever had control?
Don't we all have lack of control now and then?
All right, Nicholas, please.
Go ahead. What do you got?
Well, speaking of underrated, these two are not only extremely underrated, but we don't see them that often. And that's a goddamn shame.
What?
Hmm? That is why they are this low, okay? We need more of them. Kendo from My Hero Academia.
Oh, Itsuka Kendo?
Oh. Yeah. And Rebecca Scarlet from Black Clover.
Son of a what?
Oh.
Holy shit.
Wow.
All right, who do you want to start with?
What?
Big one.
Itsuka Kendo.
Itsuka, she has more time to shine.
God, she's adorable. She's adorable to me. I love the fact that she knocks the crap out of that little douche. Her hero outfit is a goddamn Chinese martial arts outfit. Yes, it is nice. And yeah, she doesn't really do much, which is a goddamn shame because Big Fist is a creative as hell quirk. It is Kamala Chun-Li fusion.
That's fusion effort.
I can think of some better ones, but
we saw that during her fight with
the gas guy going it all. Yeah, that is. I need more of her. I need more of her.
We're getting more of her in season 5, brother.
One day after my birthday. That is a goddamn gift to me.
Well, she looks pretty good as a modeling agent.
Oh my
god. Oh yeah, the curl.
And her dress.
All right, now let's move on to Rebecca.
Oh yeah.
The most underrated girl in Black Clover. Let's be honest right off the bat, okay?
Yeah, we did kind of forget about it.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, which is a damn shame because first of all, she looks amazing in that dress during the date. Second of all, she has to take care of like 5 siblings by herself.
Yeah.
That's a damn level of dedication and loyalty. And 3, this is the big one. I'm not going to diss these other girls, but unlike Mimosa and Noelle, she actually confessed her feelings to Asta with that kiss.
Oh, that is true.
Yeah. Yes, so in the race to his heart, that puts her just like half an inch above those two, the other two.
Like she's still behind Sister Lily.
Yes, yeah. It's not much. Yes, it's not much, but it's still just the tiniest of leads. God. Oh, I cannot. And look, I need more. She's pretty much grounding everything in that arc. Okay? She puts it all into perspective that these are people with worries and fears. And look, there's a reason my final point for Rebecca. There is a reason she's gonna get a lot more role in my story. Because I love her. Oh, I can't imagine it.
But you forgot one more thing. Redheads, you gotta love them.
I was trying to avoid that.
Well, fuck you, my boy.
Too obvious.
That was fun. You get my respect. You get my respect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll respect both choices.
Yes, 2 underrated characters to start off my list.
Nice.
I like it.
Alrighty. Let's see what we got. We're going to number 9. Okay. Tweet, tweet, motherfucker.
The fuck? Wait a minute.
Oh, wait.
Yep. Sekire Swallowtail from Black Clover.
You had to use his fucking joke for the. Wait, where's Trey?
Oh.
No, I made that joke.
Yeah, you made that joke. And that's why I'm like, seriously, you made that.
And that led to me creating the fuck the block.
Yep.
Yeah.
Like I said before, when I mentioned Noelle, my last one, it was a hard choose between her and a Sekire. But now they're on the part 2 list. She's going on because, my God, she has great development.
Too.
She has really good development. I feel sorry for her when she had to say goodbye to her past. Especially after during that whole like issue with Zag Red. And it's just, plus her in her narrow form, it was just, this is comedy relief. And that's what I put it above. But when the reveal happened and just, I love seeing her in that black dress. I really do.
Yeah.
Plus she has like, so many good cute moments, like even though they're very rare throughout the series right now, was just, I think the one that put her like on my radar was during the ending of New Page, which gave that hopeful smile, just that heartwarming smile when she sees Asta. I'm just like, you're up there. You were up there in the running, see Craig.
Yeah, though, if there's like one thing I will admit that I blame the filler arcs for, is that they made her the damsel in distress in that arc. Why?
Yeah, that was...
But again, it was a filler. So.
Yeah, we get it. Damsels in distress can work, but we wish that Sekri would have gotten more of a proactive and focused role instead of starting off with that.
Indeed.
Can I just point out that if she didn't take the cuffs off Asta and keep them with her when she was captured, they never would have found their race?
That's true.
That's true. It means she is smart. Fair.
But either way, I really am excited to see more Black Clover with both Noelle and Sucre, especially with this new animation. I really want to see what they're going to do, what they're going to look like. So, yeah. Sucre is my number 9 from Black Clover.
You get respect, brother. All right. My turn.
Yep.
Well, Nicholas here mentioned one hero. I'll mention another. Oh? And she's friends with Kendo.
Brent?
Yep. They're in the same internship. Momo Yayabosu.
Momo.
Yep.
Yamomo,
yes. Oh my god, just this girl. I don't... For being a rich girl, she's so... she's humble. Like, the fact that she's willing to tutor idiots like Kaminari and Mina is just... It's heartwarming.
Watch your mouth about the alien queen.
I know. Look, dude, she's an idiot. She's an idiot. She got
I'm just saying you gotta watch your mouth.
Oh, says the guy that dissed Cowboy Bebop.
Okay.
Oh, got you there, idiot.
Okay.
Bringing back
This is a war, okay, anyway, so Momo, she's a kick-ass. I mean, have you seen her work the pole? And her fighting style is awesome.
For God's sake.
Okay? And her hero outfit, okay? I'll admit it, yes. Uh-huh, it's sexy, yes. But her quirk? My god, the fact that she has to learn all these stuff and she has a book of info, just, it's interesting. Like, she can make a cannon, smoke grenade, Russian nestle. That's awesome, you know? Oh man, I'm so interested in the next arc, you know, because she's getting more. And the both hero movies, like Two Heroes and Heroes Rising, she has some pretty awesome moments. All right.
Agreed. And she's very reliable in those moments too.
Oh yeah, exactly. She's literally the big sister of class 1A. That's why
she's vice president of that class.
Yeah. Hey, yeah. Just and plus she's voiced by one of my favorite voice actresses, Colleen Klinkenbeard, you know?
Oh yeah. Wait until you get to me.
Okay. Well, that's my number 9.
Isn't that list just 99% that voice actress, Nate?
Nah. But you'll see.
Alrighty, all Trey. Right. What do you got, number 9?
Shotgun.
I think I'm probably gonna piss EDA off with this one because
Oh no! Oh dear.
Is he?
It's White Schnee from Ruby.
Oh.
then again, Nicholas was respectful to Brandon when he mentioned Weiss, so he has to do the same for Trey. Otherwise, he'll look like a bitch.
He's holding in that anger, I can tell.
Hey, you said to each their own for it. Okay, go ahead, Trey.
It's not anger. Trust me, it's not anger.
Alright, Trey, why do you like
Okay, in all fairness, I will admit, in my first watch through of Ruby when I was younger, I hated her too, honestly.
You're not alone.
Am I the only one?
But as I got older and I started rewatching Ruby, yes. I realized as I started rewatching Ruby as I got older, I realized something. She's the only one on the team with consistent character development.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. I am not wrong. Like, she changes from volume to volume to volume to volume. And it makes sense. The changes make sense. In Volume 1, she's a bratty, prejudiced ice princess. In the next volume, she's a supportive teammate to the two members that she had the most conflict with. In the third one, she's pretty much like she's openly playing along with their gimmicks and antics and being open about her insecurities to others. In the fourth one, she's pretty much not even an ice princess anymore by the fourth and fifth volumes. Like she's like, she acts as almost like a voice of wisdom in a sense.
Mm-hmm. You know?
And I just like that about her. Like she's one of the characters that Rooster Teeth definitely got right from a writing perspective, in my honest opinion. And I love her powers.
Yeah.
Say whatever you want about her. Her powers are awesome. Like the ability to manipulate the elements through her glyphs and dust, summoning enemies that she's defeated, accelerating her own time or freezing people in place. It's all fantastic. Like there's so much potential with it. Like I remember, have any of you guys seen the Silver fan-made trailers?
No.
Yes.
I have. They're good.
Yeah. And you remember the one where she had the glyphs and she was using that to make her crossbow bullets go faster? Like, there's a lot of potential with what she can do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'm glad that Weiss is back in Atlas, even though I wish more focus is put on her. But I am glad for what she's doing at the moment. It's finally standing up to her father, trying to do right by her family name and all that stuff. And she's actually trying to patch things up with Whitley, in all honesty, yeah. Who I also disliked at the start. But when you think about it from his perspective, you kind of understand where he's coming from.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Weishne, a little bit, but I still
she's pretty, even with that scar.
Mm-hmm. That he was a victim, that's all I can say.
Like, Brandon, that's
Of course he was a victim.
I mean, he's not completely likable, but I understand.
Okay, Nady boy.
All right, Nate, go ahead.
Okay. Brandon, I'm going to send you a video explaining why Whitley is a victim someday.
No. Okay, number 9. In the last video, I talked about Blake and Leona for being my favorite demi-humans, but they're cats. So what if... Stay with me now. What if instead of like a cat, if it's not just a dog, but a werewolf?
Then you're a furry.
Wait a minute. I only know
number 9, and Brandon might notice Lupus Regina Beta from Overlord.
Oh, look at Brandon. Oh,
yeah. Dude, not who I was thinking. Ooh.
This low, though?
Yeah, hear me out. I'll say why she's low. She didn't get much appearances in season 1 and season 2. In season 3, she got more prominence, but that was just it. I just wanted to see more of her.
That's true.
Yeah, and I've been hearing that people don't like Lupus Regina because she's just a psycho, which I have to ask, did you forget who she's working for? Zareek, not everyone over there values human lives.
Little to like none. Nobody does.
Yeah, exactly. But regardless, I still love Lupus Regina. She's a lot like Leone. She's very playful and she can be quite mischievous sometimes. Literally, she could just turn invisible and sneak up on a person and just say boo and just scare them. And she does make the occasional jokes now and then.
True.
But regardless, like, she's very positive, she's very upbeat, and if you really think about it, I would have loved to see an alternate timeline where she would have won with Aynes when he was posing as Momon. Because she has the best interactions with humans despite not liking them.
Yeah, I mean, there's only certain like lengths that Nobriel's poker face can go.
Yeah, pretty much. But on top of that psycho side, yeah, it is pretty frightening, but at the same time, it kind of fits her for being a werewolf. I mean, werewolves can be violent now and then.
Oh, you think so?
Yeah, and I also love how casual she is in battle. Like, literally, she went up against, like, a giant ogre and then walks away from it, and that ogre was, like, cooking up on fire, and she was like, do I smell hamburgers? And then the two people just looked behind her with a shocked expression. Yes. It was hilarious.
Like, Plus, her English dub voice is Alexis Tipton, who does a lot of good characters.
Yeah, Mai Hatsume, Young Trunks, the other voice for Lucina, so much.
Wow.
Yeah, that's a lot of range. But again, she's only low because she doesn't have much appearances in other seasons. But hey, maybe we'll see more of her in season 4. Yeah. I hope.
Well, that will tell if season 4 comes out. Mm-hmm. Alrighty, Eric. What do you got for number 9?
Alright, so my number 9 is Rukia Kikuchi from Bleach.
Ah! Oh shit, Kevin's happy.
What? One show to another.
Formerly captain of the 13th division under Captain Jushiro Ukitake.
Yes. And younger sister of one of my best boys, Byakuya.
Kikuchi. Mm-hmm.
So, because I just like her modesty, like, especially in the beginning, she was born middle, she was born like lower class, so she has like a sense of like groundedness and modesty, even though she likes to seem, well, orderly and austere. She does choose to interact with the normies, essentially. She kind of has a difficulty making friends, so that kind of makes it difficult with, so that kind of adds the chemistry that she has with Ichigo. And basically she likes to she has like a lot of principles in mind because of her groundedness. So I haven't seen the anime in a long time, so it's been a long time since I've seen Bleach, but that's primarily what I remember about Rukia. Very grounded, very principled.
Well, you could say she's a cool girl too.
Yeah.
And though she needs more skills in her art.
Oh fuck you! Okay, mimosa lover.
That's
nothing wrong.
Well, lover.
Wait! Ice types are effective against grass types, bitch.
And grass types more effective against water, boy.
And we went from Bleach to Pokemon. Anywho, that's my number 9. It's amusing to see you guys. It's amusing to see you guys tear each other apart. I don't even need to do it.
Oh, fuck you too, man.
Okay.
No, it's maybe while we recover.
Time to assimilate.
All right, I want to. Okay. Well, number 9 is shaping up to be the round of the Ice Queens.
What? Oh.
Oh, think about it.
Winter?
Think about it.
It better not be fucking Esdeath.
It's not Esdeath. Trust me, it is not Esdeath.
Oh, thank God. Okay.
Because, listen, I got some fantasies. She ain't in any of them.
Okay, well, who's your number 9?
Yeah, let me just place it this way. The better Schnee.
Wait. I just said winter, bitch!
Yes!
Winter
Schnee.
Winter?
I do like winter.
I said winter, damn it. Alright, go ahead.
Okay. Okay.
I want to hear what he has to say about winter.
Well, honestly, you know how they say first impressions make our lasting impressions? That's what I got from her. She's refined, she is calm, she cares about her sister, and goddammit, she can fight! Okay, look, she mastered her summons, she mastered her sword fighting with two swords. I took sword lessons. Not an easy thing to do, trust me.
No, it's not. It's not.
No, it's not. It. Trust me, it's not. And then she comes back better than ever. In volume 7, that new design is refined and beautiful. Yeah. But unfortunately, that is also why she is this low. Oh, we went 4 volumes without her. And they are making up for it in volume 8, I will confess, but I need more of her, okay? Because I think I figured out why I like her and not Weiss. Weiss, when she was first introduced, she came off as kind of an arrogant, spoiled girl. I did not get that vibe from Winter. And I think that might just be it. Might just be something that petty. Who knows? I just like Winter more.
That's fair.
Probably because of Winter left the inherited life that she had and joined the military. That discipline immediately bits that's entitled me the shit out of me.
Also, it's
because yeah.
skills and dedication is why she's Iron One's right hand woman.
Yeah, that is true.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, nice. Both. I think it's both of those. Who knows? Hell, in another universe, Weiss and Winter might have swap places, and I might like her. Who knows?
All right. Let's move on.
Yeah.
But we're talking hypotheticals. Number 9 is Winter Schnee.
Nice. Okay. Two cool girls. Wait, 3 cool girls.
Yes, three.
With the ice puns, Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Dinosaurs. The ice age.
Chill out.
Okay, let's see. Right, so shut up.
Going off to number 8. Basically, 2 girls that I really think I just really want to see more of. One from a first season that I wish we could get a second season, and one that is currently right now. We'll see them in the. The next season of their top shonen anime. Number 8 goes to Satellizer from Freezing.
What?
And Itsuka Kendo from My Hero.
What?
Yes.
Itsuka?
Yep.
Bruh.
Oh my god.
What can I say? These 2 girls are amazing. Let me go to Satellizer first. I want to talk about Satellizer. Oh boy. I thought Asuka had a bad. Oh boy. She has it worse. Because she doesn't just have PTSD. She is constantly reminded and almost sexually abused by her own family.
Oh, her brother. Yeah, her brother. Especially.
So she's Sakura Mato. God damn it.
What the fuck, yeah. Sakura Mato?
Fate Stay Night.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
But, purple hair girl, Kevin.
But I just love like her determination to become better, to get stronger. And by the end of the season, she got it. Plus, she's a blonde. And blondes are supposed to be fun. She has plenty of really good and just adorable moments. And I gotta say it, both Kill la Kill and Asuka can add Freezing to the top of fan service transformation.
Can we also point out that she eats like 20 cheeseburgers and never stays any and never gets
yes,
any weight?
Yes, because she works out every
Wait,
day!
What?
Yeah, that's yeah, bullshit right there.
No, look, there is a place, there's
a pound.
Exactly. There's a place in her cafeteria called Burger Queen. She gets like 20 burgers and eats them all.
Wait, Brandon, oh so that would make her Kasumi for Persona 5 Royal?
Yep.
I knew it.
She's a hodgepodge of a lot of great characters, isn't she?
You had to fucking bring up Persona.
But yeah, I was really bummed that we didn't get another season of Freezing because it teased it. It fucking teased it.
I think the manga's still ongoing.
Yes, it is.
Is it? I thought.
I think so.
Oh, nice.
We'll look later.
All right, I'm thinking of the spinner.
Now I'm gonna go off to Kendo. Okay, so even though Nejire completely, I just wanted her to win the competition at the beauty pageant. If Kendo would won, I wouldn't have mind that.
Yeah.
Her.
No one would have.
The dress that she wore in that beauty pageant and just, plus she knows how to do some good karate and I took taekwondo. She and I can totally bond over that.
Aww.
Plus she's voiced by one of my favorite voice actresses, Jade Saxton.
Oh
he
yeah.
Does Konoko.
Yeah.
I just.
Wait a minute. Both her, she voiced 2 characters that can kick ass. Konoko and Kendo. Huh.
Mm-hmm.
Don't a lot of girls voice characters that can kick ass multiple times?
A lot.
But I just, what really gets me to yes, that Isuka is also like Momo. She's the big sister of Class 1B. Literally. I just love that, how she doesn't see 1A as a rival like the other classmates do. She sees him as like friendly competition, wanting to get stronger, wanting to become better heroes. and I cannot wait to see what they're going to pull in season 5.
You're going to love it.
I will love it because I love my hero. I think it's, I think if we get more and more content, it'll go up. It'll go up when we ever do the anime wars again, it'll go up higher on my list.
Hell yeah.
So yeah, two girls who I think can kick lots of ass, but I wish we could see more of them, is Satellizer and Itsuka.
Nice. Big Siska, yes, agreed.
Yes.
Yeah.
I wouldn't mind sparring with her.
Go ahead, Kev. What do you got for your number 8?
Volt Weapon Deploy. Yeah, you mentioned her. Satellizer L. Bridget.
Are you?
Oh, shit. Oh, okay, all right. Well, to be honest, I switched my order up just for Brandon right now. But yes, Satellizer L. Bridget is my number 8. And like Brandon said, this girl, okay, first of all, she's not even a real L. Bridget. She was adopted into this family. And, you know, she had a good older sister. Her father was not as bad as Jacques Schnee. I will say that. He's not as bad. He's still kind of an ass, but not as bad. But her brother.
Worse than Whitley?
Way worse.
Way worse.
Because it was because of his sexual abuse. Because of her sexual abuse, she can't let anyone touch her. If she lets anyone touch her, even touch her shoulder, she'll have PTSD. Like, seriously. That's why she's the untouchable queen. Not because she's the best, but it's also because she wants to avoid being touched. It's like, it's so sad, you know? Like, just imagine you're living your whole life, you can't even let anyone touch you because you're afraid, you know? It's so sad.
Pretty understandable because everyone has their personal space.
Hell yeah. No, well, this takes to a whole level, Nate, but her fighting. Yeah, she's the untouchable queen for a reason. She is badass. Like, double acceleration and the fact that she can cut through Nova's and such. Like, best girl. There's a lot of good girls in Freezing, but Satellizer is my best girl, okay? I will say that. And I need season 3.
I confess. I gotta confess, she has Summer Ron for me.
Rana? Really?
That's just my opinion.
Damn, Brent, like, wow. Okay, well, no, Satellite's my number 8.
Alright.
What do you want from me? I like girls that get up close and personal.
You like Spike, you like a girl that can kick your ass.
Alright, your turn, Trey.
Exactly. Right,
what do you got for number 8?
Because that means that takes all the pressure. Shut
the fuck up! This is a character that I enjoy greatly in My Hero Academia that I want to have her to have more of a major role. Oh, I honestly think she should have been the main female lead. Kevin knows her. Suyu Asui, My Hero Academia.
Not gonna lie, I almost considered her for my list, but I picked someone else. Well, Kevin the Rage Quit is back.
Okay, alright. Okay.
Hey, check this out.
Talk more about
still gone? The fuck?
Go ahead, just go.
Alright, well, anyways, moving on from that. We talk about how Momo and Kendo are the big sisters of their respective classes, but we're forgetting that Suyu Asui is probably one of the few people that actually has experience being a big sister. Mm-hmm. Like, she actually has siblings that she needs to take care of. And I love how dependable she is. I like how she takes that experience and just applies it to a friend, you know? She almost never loses her composure. She's always blunt and straight to the point. She's friendly with everybody, asking them to call her by her name, her first name, which is really a personal thing in Japan, is what I call. And the fact that the only one time that she ever breaks her mask and really shows emotion was when she cries out of concern and guilt over calling her friends villains for trying to save Bakugo.
Oh, yeah.
Very compassionate towards people. She just wants to help others. She doesn't care about being the best hero or making a standout name for herself. She's just being a hero because she just enjoys the feeling of being some sort of assistance to anyone. Like, that's why she's honestly one of the best supports. Like, her interaction with Izuku sold it for me in the USJ. Like, she only had, that was probably their first conversation, and she just bounced off of him like it was no problem. And she does it even more with plenty of other times, too. And I love that.
I love how she questions, like, your power, isn't it a lot like All Might's?
Yeah, she's smart!
Oh my god, the only one that actually... The only one that actually knows the obvious. But yeah, Suyu Asui, the better version of Toad, she is easily... She slips into my number 8 spot.
Nice.
Alrighty.
Well, where the fuck is Kevin?
I don't know. Anyways,
Trey, thumbs up.
Okay, on the topic of My Hero Academia...
Yay. Seriously, where the fuck is Kevin? Is he actually doing something?
Maybe.
I don't know.
He'll catch up.
Yeah,
my number 8, I think it's pretty simple with these headphones. My third best girl, and the one that I think is a best friend to Momo Yadirozu, Kyoka Jiro. Oh.
The metal!
Yes! Rock on!
Yes.
Remember how Trey mentioned that Suyu is very underrated?
Yo, Suyu is overrated.
More underrated in comparison. Literally, like, she didn't get the recognition in the previous seasons. Like, sure, she has some good moments here and there, but not a lot, as she's a bit of a supporting character. I think I like her for the same reason that I kind of like Blaine. They're both cynical, but they're also very witty, too. Especially with Kyoka's banter with Kaminari. It's just hilarious.
Yeah.
Be my human stun gun.
Yep. She gave him the Das Boot.
I will say this, although I'm not a big fan of the pairing, they do have probably the best chemistry in the class.
Definitely. Like, if they end up as friends, that's fine, too.
Yeah.
And also her quirk, while it may not seem much, I also love how creative it is. Even though she might not get an iPhone because of that.
What?
But overall, like, Hero's powers, utilizing sound waves, that's really clever. And especially with her hero upgrade, because like, while I do like the costumes, I will admit the females are kind of leaning towards like the fan service with the skin tights. Kyoka, she just wears like a punk like rock outfit, and I love it.
True.
And the amplifiers are badass too. She can make earthquakes with her hands.
Yeah, that is amazing too.
Plus, she can like eavesdrop on anybody's conversation, so watch what you say.
Yeah, she's pretty good with stealth. Like, I am definitely gonna have her and Blake have a good friendship because of how much they have in common. Plus, I don't think I can get away with this. Her moments in season 4.
Props to her voice actor, both the English dub and sub.
Yeah.
One of the shining moments in the second half.
Mm-hmm.
It's the top, man.
Because literally, Kyoka Jiro was very, very flustered of showcasing her love for music because she didn't think it's very heroic. But it was thanks to Class 1A. And yeah, I'll admit, I'm kind of surprised that Bakugo, of all people, encouraged her a bit. I was like, really? Is that the same bully from season 1?
Character development.
Well, yeah. He still said, let's kill them with music, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he does know how to rock the drums. So
character development at a snail's pace.
Yeah, it's better than nothing.
Is that music development then?
Idiot, shut the fuck up.
We'll see.
Yeah, but the last thing I had to mention about Kyoka Jiro.
Make go on before I kill you.
Hero 2. Oh my god, that was amazing.
Yeah.
I love how supporting her parents are.
Oh, I'll have to cheer up.
Yeah, that's all I gotta say for number 8.
Wow, several of my hero girls. Damn.
Definitely.
Nice.
Alrighty,
Eric. All of them were great, except Tor.
Hey! Invisible Girl deserves more love.
Hey, she's better than Toga.
Yes. Okay, Eric, go.
Yeah, yeah.
3 words that shattered Vegeta's ego.
You no!
Smug.
What?
Yup. She, the one villain, well, former villain, that was able to shatter Vegeta's ego.
Son of a bitch.
What?
No way.
Android 18. Or as her original name was, what was it, Lazuli?
Yeah, Lazuli. Yeah.
Lapis Lazuli.
Yeah, Lapis Lazuli. Basically, she, see, there's a reason they put her further down the list. Most anime fans would have put Android 18, like, higher up on the list, because, I mean, I get it. She's cool, she's confident, she has a witty sense of humor, and she, and somehow Krill and a short midget managed to land it with her. But the problem is, that kind of makes her a little bit of a one- or two-dimensional character for the most part. She does get a little more interesting in Super, but, and is an ally of the Z Warriors, but it's not going to change the fact that she still hates Goku to this day.
Fucking wrong.
But that's probably why I like Android 18 in the first place. It's like she's, well, she's cool and she's confident. She has a sarcastic sense of humor.
True.
Then it goes to the max.
And also, like, I'm just like, really, Kevin? Lapras Azuli?
He said Lapras Azuli, so he said
Lapras. Okay, but yeah, number 8 is Android 10, the popular anime waifu favorite.
18, you said Android 10.
He's a 10, man.
Oops.
The fuck?
Well,
8 plus 10 is 18.
Oh, I see what he did there.
Of course the freaking math, of course the math tutor can do jokes like that.
Oh my god.
Go ahead, EDA. Nicholas. Number 8.
All right. I hate to do this to you guys, but this one's going to piss you off. Link Start.
Sword Art Online.
Which one?
Okay. Yeah.
Which one?
That's the thing. No. It's damn near impossible to pick between the two best girls.
No,
you.
Girls.
Which one?
It's better wisely.
I couldn't pick a tie. I couldn't pick another tie. Yeah, so I had to go with. Fuck it. Fuck it. Xenon.
Yeah, okay, God.
Oh, thank God.
If it was
we were going to kill you. We were actually going to kill you.
If it was anyone else,
I would have fucking murdered you.
Yeah, Gunner Girl.
Honestly, that's the only reason why she's number 8. I don't want to die tonight. I don't want to die a virgin.
It's not like anyone's gonna go after you anyways, so.
Oh, Kevin.
Just kidding.
Alright, yes. Yes, I admit it was a borderline impossible between to choose between Asuna and Xenon. Because they're both very, very good to me. But then again, that's just my effed up brain. Okay? I freely admit, I'm screwed in the head.
It's fine. I liked her in season one. I liked Asuna in season one. It was until after she got with Kirito and got turned into just his love interest that I started paying less attention to her.
Yeah. I didn't even like her in season one.
Let's not talk about... Hey, I thought we were talking about the reasons why we love Asuna, not reasons to shit on Asuna.
We can do both.
Okay, talk about Asuna. I'm sorry.
Oh god, the tragedy, the PTSD behind it. I got it. Giannis, I'm pretty sure everybody here would end up like her if we were in that same situation. Taking a life is not something that should ever be joked about. Let's leave it at that.
Agreed.
Okay. But in Gun Gale, she is a monster. She's a monster with that sniper rifle. Oh, okay. But that's not the outfit that does it for me. The outfit that does it for me is a cape sit. The one with the cute little ears. The ears and the tail.
Cat girl.
Yeah. Yeah. It was, and I loved her in Alicization. She literally took the powers of a goddess.
Yes.
Okay, and wiped out an entire army alive. No.
Fuck you, Jericho. She does it right.
I'm not gonna lie about her.
However, I'm gonna be 100% honest here.
Okay, one at a time.
I'll be 100% honest. The only reason she's this low is because 99% of her achievements happen in the virtual world as opposed to the real world. So she doesn't have as many feats as some of the other girls that count.
The other girls had feats?
He's talking about the girls on this list, Kevin.
Okay, I'm kidding.
From this point up, yes, they have feats.
Okay.
Feats. Yeah. She's number 8.
Okay.
However, I am going to give you guys a heads up. Asuna is now on my HMs.
That's fine.
That's fine. Dude. HMs I can live with.
Yeah, don't worry. We're not going to kill you. Yes.
Besides, it's better than Lisbeth.
Unless we're talking about a bridge.
We can't all agree on
that. Unless we talk about a bridge, Lisbeth. That's queen.
She's awesome in the
bridge. Okay, go ahead, Brendan.
Number 7, huh?
Oh, boy.
Jesus Christ. This early?
Yes, this early.
What?
Because God damn it. This series made me cry. And and we are getting a season fucking 2.
Oh, wait, is it?
Kanade from Angel Beats.
Oh my god.
I don't know why I thought it was Violet.
Oh, Angel Beats!
Yep. Kanade.
Oh god. Oh, that's.
I'm already getting more in my eyes.
I have not seen Angel Beats.
Yeah,
if you haven't watched Angel Beats, Angel Beats. Every one of you out there watching right now, should watch Angel Beats.
I'm going to be 100% honest.
This anime, this girl, my God, she made that series. I just... It is so hard to put into words about this girl, especially towards the end of the season. Especially towards the end. But
I got it. I'm 100%.
She's a literal angel, both literally and metaphorically, and she knows how to fight. She knows how to kick some ass. And I love this girl. She must be protected at all times. Even though that she doesn't want it, she must be protected. I'm literally tearing up right now. I am literally tearing up.
I'm going to be 100% honest. On my profile on FanFiction, I confess that show made me cry.
That's fine, dude.
Yeah, as you should.
Yeah, as you should. Because
if you watch that show and don't cry,
you are a heartless monster.
Something is wrong with you if you don't. But I just gotta say, the opening, "My Soul, Your Beats," when she plays the piano, I just love the show. I love every single moment of it. Nothing they did in any of the episodes made me feel any more than I have for any other character in a series. And I just, when she made that confession that we will see each other again, when she faded away to be reincarnated, I'm literally in the shoes of that character begging her not to go. And I don't know if season 2 is going to continue the story or not. I really don't know, but if it does, I will literally bawl my eyes out when I see Kanade again. I will literally stop, and I will just shed a tear for the show, because this character is just amazing. I gotta leave it here. I gotta leave it here, else I'm gonna go off on a crazy emotional rant.
Okay, yeah, because this. Okay, wow. I don't know what to say anymore. I don't know. I don't think we could.
And virtual hug, man.
Oh dear.
Yes.
This is awkward. This is very awkward now.
Somebody please talk now.
Okay, I got this. My number 7. She's one of the fastest characters in the series. And god damn it, that trick she pulled in front of Mr. Kurosaki. Oh.
Yorichi.
Yep, Yoroichi Shihoen from Bleach.
Oh.
Yeah. The biggest tease sensei. Okay? God damn it. And yes, I like the black pussy, okay? Fight me.
Oh, fuck. Damn it, Kevin.
Right, I have to make them laugh, Trey, okay? Did you not see what Brennan just said about me? Okay. Anyway, so...
What did I do?
You were making everyone depressed, Brandon. You made yourself cry. So good. Okay, I'll leave. All right. So, going to Yoruichi. Like everyone else, we didn't know who Yoruichi was besides being a black cat who could talk with a male voice. When she transformed into her true form, I simped. I am proud to admit it. So, when Yoruichi was revealed, I simped. Because who wouldn't simp with a dark-skinned, fully grown woman with purple hair and gold eyes? Come on, who wouldn't simp over that? And the fact that she trained Ichigo to use Bankai in 3 days when it would take years is impressive. This woman, she's a ninja. She was the captain of Squad 2. She can take out multiple ninjas like that. It's like, she's awesome. And the fact she can hurt Aizen when he's turning into a god? Dude, come on! But holy shit, I've seen spoilers of the Thousand Year of Blood War. She becomes an electric cat.
Yep.
Dude.
We see that in Jump Force.
I know.
Meow.
I know. And she has no problem being naked. Like, she legit can fight naked. It's a fucking hilarious. Oh my god, and her props to her sub and dub voice actors, they're awesome. They're just great. So yeah, the Yoruichi is the pussy for me. Shut up, Trey, okay? I had to make people laugh after what happened.
Trey, go.
Your turn, Trey.
Yeah.
Alright, now, I just realized that looking over my list, I'm starting to think I have a subconscious fetish for siblings. I don't know. Because, the girls on my list are sisters.
You know what? No, oh, I'm out.
I have sisters.
No,
I'm sorry.
Trey, I'm sorry. No, I'm out.
No.
Listen, Trey. As long as they're not related to you, it's fine.
Trey, you have to mention that.
Just go.
Okay, go.
Well, my number 7 list, another older sister.
Okay.
Rin Tosaka from Fate's Day Night.
What? Oh, Rin? What? What?
Oh my god, the queen of Sundays!
Damn. Yes.
And the master of Archer. Yes. Trey, please go.
Oh shit, I think I made Edo cry. Edo cry. Oh shit, he's walking away.
Wait, he cried or he died? What? Make up your mind. He hates Rin, by the way.
No, he doesn't like Rin, so that's why.
What? He legit wrote in his story. Look, he legit wrote in his story what I hate in
life. Enlighten me.
Rin Tosaka is there.
Okay. I'll enlighten you. I started like, okay, I will make him a character I thought I wouldn't like because I'm not
even ready to kind of Sunday.
But then I watched Fate Zero when she was as a kid, when she went after those her fellow classmates. Even though she was putting herself at risk in the Holy Grail War. Although I was yelling at her, get the fuck out, you moron, a girl. What she did took a lot of bravery and courage. Something that I really wasn't expecting at all. And what a great way to show off her potential as a prodigy and a mage. And also, as I'm watching Fate Stay Night, I like how she's a different spin on the Cinerary type and how she's easily able to interact with other people. Like, whether she's genuine or not, she knows how to socialize with others. Like, and I feel like that's something that a lot of other Cinderellas honestly don't. Like, they always overreact or quick to anger and stuff like that. Like, don't get me wrong, Rin is quick to anger as well, but she has better ways of composing herself instead of just bitch slapping the shit out of someone.
Or shooting them with water.
Yes, that. And I like how she reminds me of Megumi Fushiguro from Jujutsu Kaisen, in a sense that she has such a pragmatic, idealist views, in a sense, but when the chips are down, she does genuinely want to help others that are in danger in front of her. You know, like for example, when she saved Shiro's life, she didn't have to do that. She is a maid. She is obligated to let him die because he was a witness to magic and she had no knowledge of his magical knowledge. But no, she used her amulet that was extremely valuable and potent and would probably helped her later on in the war to save his life because he is an important person to her sister Sakura. And that's easily respectable. And also she is adorable as hell. Like I remember that scene after she was getting suplexed by that wrestling girl in the season in the series finale and she just lying and she was laughing, he's like, she's like a freaking cat.
She's awesome.
So, yeah, man. Rindo Saka, probably one of the few Cinderellas I actually think is adorable. And yeah, but if there is one downside, her micromanagement. I would not be able to deal with that shit that well.
She's going to have a technology.
No, her micromanaging. She is a control freak.
She
really
have that problem.
Hey, what the fuck?
And you people wonder why you don't like date, wouldn't want to date her.
No one would want to date you.
Oh, Nate, what do you got?
Okay, number 7. Honestly, I think these two females are the best embodiments of like a royal girl due to their development and in some cases their characters.
Royal girl?
Royal, yeah. Number 7. Edie, I am sorry in advance, but I had to go with my second best girl for Ruby, Waishni, but tie with her, my second best girl in Persona 5, Haru Okumura.
Hey, Dieresis.
Yeah. I mean, oh boy.
Like, saying two girls that Edie hates in a row? What the hell, guys?
I'm not trying to trigger you, EDA. Why's just grew on me?
I think we're murdering EDA. I'm sorry.
You know what?
This is just his funeral.
Look, if it shows, then that's fine. That's fine.
Yeah, I'll just like start with Weiss to get out of the way just to make it easy. Because like what Trey said, she was bad in Volume 1. But if you really think about it, I felt like the show did that on purpose. It was like the Rocky. Well, there were like other moments that Wise that I will admit I can kind of understand why she left Atlas. I mean, if she would have stayed in Atlas, she would have remained the same. And there were like 3 moments in particular that maybe grew on Wise. The first moment was when she tackled Flint into that erupting geyser. I was like, okay, she's no longer the spoiled rich girl. The second moment that made me appreciate her is when she called up everyone in the party, just like, you guys don't know what we went through in Beacon, you dumb people. And yeah, she's not wrong. She was there at the fall of Beacon and she suffered a lot as much as everyone else does. And I definitely agree with Ironwood. She isn't in the wrong.
Nope.
And the third moment, and this was the one that made me fully appreciate Wise, and this was the moment that got me like, okay, Volume 7 is in the right direction. And that was the moment where she stood up against her father and exposed him of his true colors. That is the most satisfying moment ever. You have no idea how excited and happy I was when Jacques got arrested. Yakshni, you're under arrest. Can I do that?
Adorable.
Yeah, and that also led to her having funny moments, especially in Volume 8, where she got Augustus Gloop in the pipe thanks to Nora. Oh,
I died.
Augustus
died.
That was hilarious.
As I mentioned,
Yeah, it was just so good because she's very quirky.
It was a once in a lifetime experience.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, she's very quirky, very sweet in the recent volumes, and yeah, she kind of grew on me. But I think that's enough about Weiss. Let's talk about Haru Okumura now, aka the Beauty Thief, aka Noir. Oh, God. I don't understand why people don't pay attention to Haru that much. I get that she appeared a bit late in the story, but did you really pay attention to it? She suffered a lot, way more than Weiss and Lucy and any other royal slash rich girl combined. Because literally, she was used as a political tool by her own father.
Yeah.
To the point that she forced into an arranged marriage to a guy that is creepy, similar to what the guy that was trying to hit on Yukiko when Eric mentioned it earlier. I feel bad for Haru. But that isn't enough to make her break. And you know how like most of like the royal girls start out being like arrogant and very rude? Haru isn't. She's sweet. She's very humble. She's very mature.
She's also partly sadistic.
Yes. I will admit that.
You would be too after that.
Yeah. And if you really think about it, during that time of the arc, she is the only one that understands Morgana's true feelings. And she just met him not too long ago. It shows how very understanding she is. After all, she's in the same year as Makoto.
Yep.
So it makes her like one of the more level-headed members of the Band Thieves, and honestly, that is very helpful.
Mm-hmm.
And my God, what they did with her in Persona 5, the games for her abilities, it's just incredible. Especially when you set up Tetracon and Makarakon, and the Royal version, they just upgraded.
Yes.
It was just amazing, and no lie, when you reject her after she confessed her feelings, God, that hurts! It freaking hurts!
Why the hell would you ever reject her?
Because you may be in another relationship with another character, which is very likely in Persona.
Yeah.
Yeah, very, very likely.
It hurts, too, because Haru has suffered a lot in her lives, and she needed all the comfort that she could get. Also, one thing I gotta add, I love her Phantom Thief outfit, because while I do like the other female Phantom Thief outfits, again, they're leaning on the fan service thing with the skin tight outfits. But Haru? No! All she wears is a hat, shorts, tights, a shirt, and a mask. She looks like an actual beauty thief.
Still doesn't leave a lot to imagination, though, does it?
Pretty much. But hey, it's Persona. They can do some crazy stuff. But yeah, Weiss and Haru, they're my favorite examples of the royal girls. That's my number 7.
Fair. Go ahead, Eric. What do you got?
It's another video game character, but this one is enigmatic in some pretty endearing ways.
Oh?
Cynthia from Pokemon.
Oh my God, the best champion ever.
I added her further up on the list this time.
Shit, Trey.
I love Cynthia.
But what was it? Of course, she is primarily a video game character, so most of the personality we can derive from her is from what we see in the Diamond and Pearl anime, but she does show up again in the in Black and White, Black 2, and White 2. Video game. She's always like, what makes her enigmatic is that she can be both like a serious trainer about Pokemon, taking care of them and helping trainers out with their Pokemon, but also at the same time she's always seen eating ice cream for some reason. She could be she could be a bit airheaded as to where as to what flavor she wants.
Get all of them, like
to be fair, I've been there too. Sometimes, like, if I'm like ordering food, I just don't know what to eat because I've got like a huge appetite and everything. Same, so, same. her favorite Pokemon always seemed to be her favorite Pokemon seems to be Garchomp through all the versions she's in.
Dude, exactly. Also, one thing I had to point out: her Garchomp is the only one that took out Paul Sorterra, because Sorterra never lost any other battles. It only lost against Garchomp.
Oh yeah. Good thing she put Paul in her place. That
prick. In his place.
Wow. Making me feel guilty for passing on her during the last time in the Smash Bros.
Yeah.
Videos.
Yeah.
How dare you?
But yeah, and also the fact that she's like, well, the fact that she's champion, man, I'm like, I don't know if that's like, I'm like, if that doesn't tell a lot about her, I don't know what does. Number 7 is Cynthia.
Plus, he's hot.
She's the first female champion of the games.
She's, Kevin, don't reduce her value, man. She's classy.
Okay, she's classy. Okay. Damn,
all right, so. EDA. What is your number?
Can't you be hot and classy?
You don't care.
All right, we just go.
All right. Well, the suit was brought up earlier, but I am going to make a slight change.
What?
From Demon Slayer.
What?
It changes.
It is Kaori Tsuyori.
Sorry. The doctor! Yes. Oh, the doctor! The one that she met.
No! No!
What? Wait, no. I guess. Hold on, let me.
This is Shinobu's little adoptive sister.
Oh!
Kano!
Yeah.
Okay.
I got
Kanjuro's future wife.
Wait a minute. I just realized something. Sorry. Trey had Weiss, you had Winter, now you have, what's her name again? Kano, yeah. And Trey had Shinobu. You guys are switching the older and younger siblings.
Oh yeah, we did.
Yeah, talk about Kanoa.
Oh shit, I killed him. Fuck.
Oh boy.
Do we need to pause the record?
Go ahead.
There he is.
Okay. This girl, to me, this girl is adorable. Oh, she is adorable to me, okay? Hey, first of all, her backstory. Who sells to girls like that?
A lot of people, apparently.
What monster does that? I don't want to meet... If I even meet them, I'm going to punch them in the face. Man, woman, child, I don't give a shit. Okay, I'll punch them in the face for selling her. She's so adorable. She lets a coin decide what she does because she's never had to make decisions for herself. I want to heal this girl. And plus, unlike a lot of demon slayers who join to kill demons for glory, she actually has some compassion for demons. I mean, she could have just ignored the Raven's order and killed Nezuko regardless. She didn't. That showed something about her depth. And yeah, I definitely ship her with Tanjiro. Dang. What can I say? I think they just get along really well. Oh, there's just something about them that clicks with me. I don't know what it is. But yeah, she was kind of brought in late into the series. At least in the anime, so she can only go this high.
And that's fair.
That's my number 7.
Nice.
Respect. Nice.
She gets more screen time later on. I'll tell you that, Eden.
Thank God. She gets more
focused. And her power's OP.
Learn coin toss from her, okay?
Trust me, her power's OP in the manga. All right, Brandy?
All right, number 6. I apologize in advance.
What? Oh shit, no.
What? It is my last tie, actually, too.
Okay, that's last fine.
Tie. Yep. One from a series that Trey knows very, very well as everyone else here. And one that actually is starting to grow on me. And what I can say is that they both rock the pigtail look. Rin Tokusaka from the Fate Stay series.
Oh,
shit.
And Tamaki from Fire Force.
Yes!
Yes!
Oh, great. Great.
He's gone.
Good job.
Oh, he can't bring Maki back.
Oh, yeah, it's true.
He can't have Maki again, so he's got to pick the second best.
Nate, chill. Don't. Come on, man. There can be worse characters, okay? There can be worse characters than Tamaki. Brandon, please go.
Oh,
man.
Enlighten me, Brandon.
Yay.
Oh, dear.
First off, Ren.
All right.
She is my tsundere queen. She is the reason why I think tsunderes are adorable, especially in Fate Stay Night Unlimited Blade Works. Just that animation style is just gorgeous. And I just love the fact that she was, because we know that Fate Stay series has like a different route for endings of like people that like have one love interest. This one was more tailored towards Rin, and I like that, especially during the confession, but it was a confession towards the end of the series, and it was wholesome, it was beautiful, and I just like her other like the spin-offs of the different series with her design, like in Fate Extras, that was actually pretty good to look at. And also in Fate Grand Order, the Babylonia one. Holy hell. Yes.
But wasn't she possessed by some kind of spirit or something in that one?
I think so, yeah. I think she was like a goddess. Or like a god, whatever. But either way, I love Rin because especially she is a master of my boy, Archer. Just, if anyone can handle that smooth guy, it is the girl who has a problem with control, and yet it doesn't really bother me that much. But it can be overwhelming, and I do see the negative side to that. But Rin is just wholesome, honest, and just totes adorable in certain parts of the Fate Stay series.
Mm-hmm.
So now let's get to everyone's really big eyebrow raise, which is Tamaki from Fire Force. Okay.
You want eyebrow raising? Wait till you get to me.
I will say this. Yes. The fan service used for Tamaki is overused. It is. Don't get me wrong. But the recent episodes that she has more development. And especially when she unlocks the next stage of her Nekomata. When she literally basically almost becomes a fire cat. That is actually pretty damn cool. But also, yes, she is voiced by Jade Saxton.
I'm also gonna say something controversial about Tamaki. This is not a knock to any of the other characters. I like them, but she's kind of the only character that has character growth in Fire Force Company 8.
Holy shit.
That is true. And I just... And I'm pretty sure, like, did anyone else notice that even though, yes, we know this trope is cliche, there's an accidental kiss when Shinra
accidentally gave her a little peck on the cheek.
On the cheek during a guy with my stars!
Oh, Becca. That
guy was annoying, though, so I fuck him, though.
I ship that pairing more than Ivana. Fuck Ivana.
Yeah.
Hey!
But it's just that there are certain moments that the Lucky Letcher thing just made me laugh as well. There are certain moments that made me laugh. Like, the obvious Tamaki is right there and the sister is basically thinking that the fake one who is clearly sounding like a dude is the real one. Are you that much of an airhead?
It's Iris, so what do you expect?
Well, whatever. I really enjoy Fire Force because Fire Force was something that I didn't know if I was getting. That one, I will admit, I didn't know if I was going to get into that much.
Fair.
But I'm starting to like it more and more, and all of the characters are actually, I'll say this, they're better than Soul Eater. I will say this.
Ow.
I'm sorry. They are. They have more development, and they're not annoying.
Ouch.
I mean, I'm not surprised considering you don't like Maki. I meant Maka.
Maka.
How did I was going to slap you, Nate. I was going to slap you.
I'm already triggered with what Brandon said earlier, okay?
I love the pout on your face during the whole thing. I love it.
So that is my number six. Those two girls, the Tsundere who rock the pigtail walk.
Honestly, I wouldn't be as much trickier if she was lower on your list, but tying her with the Queen of Sundries? Really? That's why I'm being triggered.
Okay, it's my turn. Well,
sue me. Go ahead, Kev. Number six.
Go ahead.
Well, Brandon, remember what you said about Soul Eater? Fuck you. Because one of my girls is from Soul Eater, you piece of shit.
I'm sorry, Soul Eater, after the first half, Soul Eater was just boring after that.
Alright. Yeah, it's Blair. It's Blair.
It's not Blair, it's Tsubaki.
Yeah, it's Tsubaki.
There we go.
I knew it.
She's the only good girl. Well, not that, really. No, but still, Tsubaki. This girl, oh my god, she's just literal waifu material. She will just support you. It's amazing, you know? It's just on her backstory with her brother, like, he always wanted to just do whatever. She did whatever he wanted, even though she wanted to play house. It's just like the compassion. Ah, just like when she's the only one that can handle Black Star.
Yeah.
Like, dude, that gets my respect, okay?
That's a lot of dedication for her.
I know. And she's not a slouch. Like, you guys have seen how fast she is, how badass she is. Like, and the fact that she can transform to multiple weapons, yes. And her fight against her brother, dude, just when she won and she held his soul, I'm like, why you gotta do this to my girl? I wish she had more, especially since, yes, Brennan, I agree. The second half was kind of,
yeah.
Still, Tsubaki is still clearly the best girl. Even though she is dubbed by Monica Riel, she's still awesome. So yes, Tsubaki is my number six.
It's also ironic that she also voiced Sekirei too.
Yeah.
Fuck you.
I'm just saying the facts, okay? I'm not
Nate,
trying to.
I get you. You're triggered, but fuck you. Oh, Trey's gone. So what do we do?
We'll just go off to Nate, and then when Trey jumps back in, we'll
okay. All right, number six. On the topic of the Fate franchise, people are talking about Saber, the original one, but for me, I'm gonna go with Mordred from Op. Yep.
Yeah, boy.
What the fuck? Whoa.
Honestly, this was a toss-up between her and Ruler because they're both good. But I ultimately went with Mordred because I think her dynamic with the rest of the cast, even with the original Saber, was actually quite interesting because, like EDA mentioned, the anti-heroes thing, Mordred just wants to prove his or her worth. And I could definitely understand it. Plus, she's not like the typical like knight that's just like all about honor and code. I mean, sure, she has some level of code and honor, but she just does whatever she wants. She's pretty much a rowdy kind of person, but she does it in a good way. And I actually kind of find it cute now and then, especially when she was chasing around a cat in that one scene while her master was on the phone. That was just comical. And plus, the armor and her abilities, it's just incredible. Literally, her fight against Berserker and her final fight, it was just amazing. I was just like blown away. And even though when she met her end, when her master offered like, hey, go form a contract with another master, but she's like, nah, I think I'm good here. That really took a nice turn. And also, she's props to Erica Limbeck for voicing her in the dub. That was just amazing.
Oh, yeah.
She's like one of the few voice actors that I consider a big contender for the new queen of video game voice acting. Without a doubt.
I agree.
But yeah, that's my number six, Mordred.
All right, so we're going to go ahead and go back to you, Trey. We just went off to Nate because we missed you there. So go ahead.
Yeah, for some reason my internet's fucking up, so I'm on my I'm going off my mobile hotspot for now.
Okay.
So anyways, my number six. My number six, finally a character that has no siblings, as far as I'm concerned.
Oh.
But instead, she takes a new place by being a literal goddess. I am talking about the minor war goddess, Bishamonten from Noragami.
From Noragami!
Oh, Noragami!
Yeah, that is a surprise. Okay.
I was not expecting Noragami.
I like Noragami. I don't think anyone knows. It's been so long since I've seen it, but I still remember it fondly.
I haven't even seen it. Wow.
What I like about Bishamonten is how she's probably the most compassionate god, divine being in the series. Like, she purposefully looks for lost souls and pretty much puts them under her just so she can give them a home. She's pretty much like your portable homeless shelter of the gods. And I feel like that's a very touching thing about it. And what we learn about her, how her reasoning for hating Yato, because all of her former regalia, I believe they were called, got corrupted, and Yato was forced to kill them to save her life. And honestly, I can understand her anger. Like, while I wouldn't say she should be trying to kill Yato for it, I can understand her being angry and grief-stricken by that incident. You know, pretty much all that work you put into to saving these people suddenly just gone in an instant like that. It's a goddamn shame. And it almost happened again with that fucking prick who purposefully started corrupting her just so she could only have one regalia, him. That selfish piece of shit. And it was so satisfying when she kicked him out. I forgot his name, but I don't care. But overall, I also like how effective she is in combat. Like, she goes from using Guts' berserk sword to dual-wielding pistols, then using a lion tamer whip that can smash skyscrapers.
That is incredible.
She definitely lives up to her title as War Goddess, and I loved her ever since I first saw Noragami, and I have to put her on this list. I guess I have a thing for chicks that can kick ass.
Noragami is awesome.
Yeah, dude, that was a shock. All right, Eric.
Number six, and you've heard of this anime over and over again, and I've said it over and over. Runa One Half's Akane.
Oh. There we go.
She's literally the leading female of the entire anime. And this is really, really where I start to dive into the fiery personalities here. She's as much a martial artist as what was it? She's as much a martial artist in the show, along with pretty much everybody else. And she's literally the prize of everybody's possession. Literally, most of the quote-unquote villains or anti-heroes of the anime are those who are simping over Akane. So that's why she's always late for school, because she can't really get to class unless she has to like spar with somebody, or somebody's gonna go like, please love me, Akane. So, but when it comes to her relationship with Ranma, she's very vulnerable, stubborn, relentless, and pretty short-tempered. She'll, every time some chick wants to like hit it up with Ranma or whatever, she gets super angry and jealous.
Agreed, man.
And part of the time is because Ranma acts like an idiot, and well, he is kind of an insensitive prick, but then again, she's just as equally insensitive as he is, so I guess it kind of evens out. Even though these two are technically arranged marriage the whole series, there's a genuine connection there beyond the whole like parental forcefulness.
Enough.
So number six is Akane Tendo from Ranma One Half.
Damn, nice.
Alrighty, EDA. On that note for you.
So, which waifus? They are few and far between.
witches.
But that's because they go for quality over quantity. And I have two of the best ones right here. Ruby from Rosario Vampire.
Ooh.
And Wiz from Konosuba.
Oh! Wiz?
Oh, dear, Brandon.
Wait, does Brandon not like Wiz?
I don't think he likes the majority of characters in Konosuba.
Oh, shit.
Listen, at least it's not one of the other three.
That is fair, but it's just Konosuba in general.
Brandon, think about it like this. He could have chosen Blair from Soul Eater.
That's better! I like Blair
no,
more.
No, it's not!
She's a cat.
Brandon, now you know how I feel when I got triggered earlier. But yeah, continue.
Okay,
go, Nicholas.
Go.
Let's start with Ruby, shall we?
Yep.
No.
Okay. This woman has been persecuted her whole life just because of what she is. And then she finds a home and she tries to protect it. God, I love that. But I will admit, the anime screwed her over big time.
Usually.
Because once again, like everything else with this series, the manga is 10 times better.
Yep.
I mean, when you get to the second part in the manga, Jesus Christ, she's basically a magical Black Widow. Spying and gathering information. She is so powerful, it actually scares me. Okay? She is the second best girl in that series after Mizune to me.
Sure.
Now let's move on. Let's talk about Wiz.
Oh boy. Okay.
I love her. Yet she was actually a demon general, but left because she didn't want to fight. But she is sweet, she is kind, and yeah, her magic shop isn't the best. But at least she's doing something productive with her life. Unlike the main three girls. And also, let's not beat around the bush. She is terrifying with her ice power. You saw how she reacted when she found out her house was killed someone. God damn, she terrified. And the movie made her that much more powerful. I can see why the Demon King picked her as the generator for the shield. I don't get why people like the three main girls, because to me they're all pieces of shit. But Wiz is one of the few decent people in that whole series. Yeah. Those are my witchy waifus.
Okay.
Ruby and Wiz.
Alrighty. So, halfway mark. Number five.
Fuck you, Wiz.
You guys know how much I liked Toga from the last video.
No, not another yandere.
She's not the only bloodsucker that I actually like. And she's from the same
bloodsucker.
She's from the same series that Nate's waifu is from.
What?
Shaltier Bloodfallen.
Oh my god! Oh,
for a second, I thought you were going to say Mocha from Rosario Vampire.
That could have been him.
Damn, Shaltier!
For the best.
Thank god, yes.
So yes, Shaltier Bloodfallen. Because here's the thing. Unlike Albedo, she does stuff, okay? Besides just simp for us.
Well, she was mind controlled.
Well, she was mind of the place that was doing something. Because she also attacked a raider a thieves guild just by herself. And I'm just, I just love her. Just, she's that, that she really looks like the Yu-Gi-Oh card of Vampire Fraulein.
She just, does. That was the first thing that comes to mind when I first saw the show.
Yeah. But it's just, her like chemistry between Ainz and the other floor guards is just so good. I really do like it. How her aura and Mare are they basically treat her like siblings, having those like sister brother arguments and all that. That's just cute. And I just love like her antics when she's trying to get with Ainz, but because she's I literally like cracked up when I heard this. Like, she's only been with girls. I'm just like,
oh yeah, in season 3 when she said it, that made me laugh.
Wait, what?
Yeah, that actually happened.
Yeah, that actually happened in season 3. She said she's only been with girls because it's the only person, the only good man you can find is dead one, and that's Ainz.
Also, I love the fact that she's trying to look like a mature woman by stuffing
her bra.
Yeah.
But she's like the curse of a lot of short girls. She is flat as a board.
Yeah.
They can't all be Hestia.
That's true.
True. But it's also like her abilities. She's a vampire with a lot of cool abilities. And I like vampires like Alucard with his abilities. Hers is like both like supportive regeneration and does tons of damage. Plus Valkyrie, Blood Valkyrie arm.
I loved it. That was
even
awesome.
Though she was mind controlled, that design was really, really cool.
I also thought it was a dragon. I won't lie.
I will ask this, why isn't she the overseer of the guardians and Albedo is? Why?
I don't know. Not enough fan service, I guess?
Probably.
But she is the guardian of the first, second, and third floor of Nazareth, so that is some props. And plus, like I said before, she could be like, she is like Toga, she could be very sadistic. That's a nice version.
Honestly, yeah, I prefer Xiaotira over Toga any day.
Because she will just like literally just mock you while she's like beating you to a pulp with Brain from season 1. And Nate, you probably saw this in season 3.
Oh, yeah.
When I said to give the thieves a merciful death.
Oh, dear.
Oh yeah, when I saw that, I was like, yep, that's one vampire you don't want to mess with.
Well,
but there are like really like cute moments, especially when she's like depressed in season 2, she's trying to get hammered and she's a vampire, so it's impossible, so it's funny trying to see her trying to get drunk.
I also love the fact that she has to pose as a chair in season 2. That made me laugh
so much.
God damn it, Cheeto. Just how kinky
can you make this chick?
Also,
her English dub voice actress, Felicia Angel, is just, I love her work.
Yeah, you're also going to love this, Kevin. She's Kahaku from Dr. Stone.
Ooh,
and also she's the Supreme Kai Time from Dragon Ball's universe.
That's funny.
Oh yes, she may be like not the most like powerful in the Guardians of Nazareth, but she is to me one of the best noticeable waifus in the group. So Xiaotira is my number 5.
Yeah.
One other. Huh. Okay. Well. My first time.
Oh.
All right. Well. Let me get the ingredients. Beauty. Intelligence and a bit of tsundere-ness for Tai. Two of the my personal opinion, good waifus that can cook, Erina and Alice Nakari from
Food. Yeah, right. Yeah. Erina's a bit of tsundere I can tolerate too.
Why do you fucking hate the well, you asshole? Okay,
I'm kidding.
I'm kidding.
Question for me, okay?
All right. But okay. Let me start with Alice, because Alice, honestly, I like her a little more than Erina. When we got introduced to her, she just looks at Soma when he's cooking, like that intelligent look. And then she has this air around her, but then when she runs into Ryo, he's like, "Hey, Ryo, why are you standing there?"
Like, oh, you told me to stand there, didn't you?
Just like, she's such a joy. Honestly, she gives me Lizana vibes.
And Nanjirei.
Yeah. Exactly. I think she's a combination of Lizana's looks and Nanjirei's personality. Add that with a little albino-ness. Yeah, and her cooking, damn, it's amazing. And plus, I love how she teases everyone. It's so entertaining. Especially with her cousin, Erina. Erina, yes, she's typical tsundere. She was kind of a bitch before, but her reasoning for being like this, you know, being the god tongue, having all this expectation, she's not a bad kid, you know? Like, we see in the past, like, she did care. Like, she had people, even with Alice, like, as much as Alice kind of annoys her, she likes Alice, you know? It's like, and plus, my god, the way she cooks and the fact that she gives Soma advice without telling him the advice, it's like, their dynamic, I'm like, dude, these two are meant for each other.
Also, one thing I gotta point out, the reason why she gets mad at Soma is because he's a troll on purpose. He provokes her intentionally.
Yeah, especially when Hisako was like, "What were you doing with him, with her?" He's like, "Oh, well, I just pushed Erina to the floor." What? It's like, "Oh, don't lie, Erina. You liked it." Ooh.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I do not blame her for getting mad at him.
It's like, but still. Okay, Nate, you're going to love a lot of the moments with Erina in season 3.
I know. I've heard a lot of it. I can't wait.
So yeah, those two can cook. They're beauties. I would let them cook for me forever because they're just amazing.
Yeah, yeah. Wow. Bringing the nice.
Yeah. I like how Nick. Oh, God. Did try and leave again?
Maybe his internet is unstable yet again.
Oh, dear. Yeah, okay, so, go ahead. Go ahead, Nate.
We'll do the same thing. So, Nate, go ahead.
Okay. Number 5. This is my second tie. And those two are the embodiments of joy and upbeat. For the first one, Corina from Pokemon XY.
What?
Yep. And I with her, and you're going to love this, Kevin, Ryoko Satin for Scientific Railgun.
What?
What?
Who was the first choice I missed?
I said Corina from Pokemon XY.
Okay.
What? Yeah, that got old, yeah.
Guys, it doesn't work unless it's spontaneous.
It doesn't work unless I did it.
Honestly, those two, not only they're adorable, but they're also a form of positive energy. And they're not afraid to kick butt. So I'll talk about Corina first.
Yes, please.
Like what Aaron mentioned about Cynthia, this version of Corina comes from the anime. Literally, her first appearance, she was a lot better than how she was in the games.
Yeah.
And her main Pokemon being Lucario, that just sold it for me. Lucario's just awesome.
Oh, yeah. That's why it was the mask of a fighting type.
Yeah, she wanted the Master Mega Evolution to the point where she has to get like 100 consecutive wins with Lucario. It's amazing.
And she has to get proof of each Pokemon that she beat, even if she has to put ketchup on Pikachu's paw and put it in a book.
Yeah, I love how she's able to make like the Pokemon's paw for memories. That's just adorable, in my opinion.
Oh.
And her overall character arc, especially with her bond with Lucario, it's pretty good. Because if you really think about it, Lucarios understand human emotions the most because of their aura. And when Lucario went berserk after Mega Evolution, I won't lie, I did feel bad for Corina, but I did love how she didn't give up. She still kept on going.
Mm-hmm.
And her gym battle with Ash, while it may not be like the best gym battle in XY, it's definitely very good too.
Honestly, I think that's the best out of that series, because I did not like the other gym battles, honestly.
I actually kind of like the Olympia and Wolfric battle. Those two are good too, so.
Wolfric kind of suck, honestly. All right, go your next choice.
Yeah. And one thing I gotta mention, thank God he came back from Pokemon Journeys. I am so happy.
And Dragonite versus Lucario was fucking badass.
Yeah, a freaking Derby Dragon taking out a Mega Evolved Lucario.
Oh,
don't mess with the pseudo legendaries.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, but that's enough about Karina. Let's talk about Sotin. Honestly, I was like watching the certain franchise back in high school, but I fell out of it because of goddamn Coracle. But if there's one thing I gotta say about Scientific Railgun, Sotin is a fresh up breath air. While she doesn't have powers, she's always have a pivotal role in the story, always being like the one that always has to cheer out the party with just her upbeat, even if it means flipping Oriyama's skirt over and over and
well,
over.
Well, it helps.
Yeah. Yeah. It definitely shows how quirky she can be, and also she does have a good connection with the modern world. So I definitely appreciate how open-minded she is about like the other areas.
Oh yeah.
And just because Sotin doesn't have powers, that does not mean she's not useless. Literally, no joke, when I first saw her bring up the bat, I was like, oh shit, she's about to go GTN in these moments.
No, trust me, season two, she's gonna have a lot more bat action.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Honestly, and also props to both Karina's and Sotin's voice actors. They did a great job.
Yeah, especially since I think Brittany Lawson, the voice actress for Juvia did Sotin. That was great.
Mm-hmm.
All right, go.
All right, Trey.
Trey, your turn.
All right. Now I'm gonna say this for absolute certainty. This one has bigger breasts than any of your girls.
Say what?
Which isn't hard considering both her breasts are the size of Mount Everest. I am talking about Diane from Seven Deadly Sins.
What?
Holy shit. Wow. Nicholas, that is not...
That's the new meme right there, that face.
Okay.
Jesus.
Okay.
Hey.
Listen, Elizabeth, I'm fine with that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You mentioned that. Now that you mentioned that, that's probably the reason why Diane appealed to me so much. Like, honestly, to some people, her jealous fits should come off as annoying. But considering how much I hated Elizabeth when I was watching Seven Deadly Sins at the time, I was like, yeah, you beat the shit out of Melia, that's where shit takes. I was yelling at Melia.
That's great.
Dude, are you serious? Come on. No, on a serious note, I like Diane for who she is, though. She's a fun character to watch in Seven Deadly Sins, even, and although I'm not the biggest fan of King, her interactions with him, they are actually pretty heartwarming and touching, and I am glad that they found happiness together. And the scene where she got her memories back and was telling King after their first victory after season one, that honestly put a honestly got a smile on my face, which made me all the more pissed off at fucking, what was his name, the Sin of Love, Gother. When he took away her memories, that made me pissed off as hell.
Also, so on the topic of Gother, I love how Gother just pointed out her true height and weight. She just started beating him sensitively. It was just so funny.
Hey, don't ever judge a woman's height or weight, man.
Exactly.
Their age.
No. You can judge them. You just can't say them out loud.
Also, another thing that appealed me to her is the fact that, like Toph, she's an Earth girl. Like, I love her Earth magic.
Never mess with
her. And how she uses her national treasure, I think that's what it's called.
It's
sacred treasures. I got it half right.
National treasure with Nick Cage? With Nicolas Cage?
Hey, nothing wrong with national treasure. I like those movies, okay?
Well, her sacred treasure, a giant warhammer that she can jam into the ground and use as like a magical lightning rod. It's fucking badass.
Maybe you should and ram it's something. Maybe you need to ram into her national treasure.
What? What the fuck?
I don't think I would fit.
Christ! How many? That was not. Those were not shots. Those were. What that was a the... carpet bombing. That was carpet bombing right there, my friends.
I think I'm gonna end it right here. You guys know what she's up.
Okay.
Diane's up. <fine. laughs>
Jesus Christ, Eric!
Dude, never fought before. I fucking kill you.
No, you won't.
Yes, he will.
No, he won't.
Who's next?
Me. No. Okay.
Christ.
Okay. Number five is the sail trotting archaeologist and historian of Luffy's crew, Nico Robin.
Yes, Nico.
Because
wait, what? Brennan?
Did you rage quit again?
Yeah.
Bro, did you just rage quit, Brennan?
Yep. He did.
He said Why? Robin. He said Robin. He didn't say Nami. He said Robin.
I said Robin, dude.
What do you have against Robin?
Is it the fact the fandom loves Nami more than Robin? That's why.
I love Robin, dude. I never liked Nami for the fact that she was a gold digger, man.
I don't think anybody likes Nami.
Trey does.
I like Nami. I just like Robin more.
Yeah. All right.
Well, because like Robin is like, well, like she's one of those like handful of anime characters that doesn't like act very comical. She's more like calm, collected, reserved, and more
logical. She's a straight man.
More logical, yeah. And basically she's like the intelligent brains of the group, and she tends to respect Luffy more, even when he is acting impulsively.
No, basically normally.
Yeah. So she's always like piecing together like data, seeing connections. She's pretty intelligent, all things considered.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
She has like a, she also has like a very, I don't know, shall we say, almost motherly charm about her, where she's like, she could be pretty maternal for like Chopper or Toko.
Besides Brooke, she is the oldest in the crew.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And no joke, that the CP9 arc, oh my god.
Oh, I'll say whichever you will about One Piece, that is one of the greatest anime arcs ever.
But also, you just gotta love that she has like a dark, morbid sense of humor at times.
She's very cynical. I can imagine her and Blake just hanging out, just having tea and reading a book.
Has any of you guys seen the fourth One Piece movie?
No. Yes, actually.
Yeah, what?
Where they were going on like this giant race against the former Marine guest Barney.
Yep.
Oh, that's...
Yeah, like, what was it? Who was that little kid that was that was actually a girl?
I don't remember.
And snuck onto the Straw Hat pirate ship. I love how she just like takes the gun, gives it to the kid, and she's like, show us what you're really made of, or were you just bluffing? Like so nonchalantly. She's like very nonchalant about everything. She doesn't even need to put any emotion to it.
Even with her like act knowing? Nah, I'll say it.
But yeah, number five is Robin.
Nah, you get a clap for that one, Eric.
I honestly thought it was Nami, dude.
Oh, no, fuck no.
Fuck you're Nami.
Plenty of better girls.
Okay, redheads, you gotta love them, but I don't love Nami.
are you trying to drown her?
Yeah, take the ball and chain, hook it up to her, let her sink to the ocean.
Mm-hmm. Oh my.
Okay, Nicholas.
Let's go.
All right. This series can be abbreviated into four letters. DRRR. Durara.
Durara.
Who is it?
Now there's a lot of good girls. But I gotta give it up to Henri Sonohara.
Henri?
Yeah. Oh, dear.
I got Brandon's approval.
Even Nate took off his glasses.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Psycho.
Yeah.
Ah, yes.
Yeah.
I mean, you want to talk this girl. I don't care that she calls herself a parasite. I will get close to her. And yes, that's what she said. Okay? Hey, I beat you to a demon. Okay.
Not worth my time.
Hey. Yeah. Okay. Her backstory is just, dying. And then she takes the blade that was used to it and tries to do some control it. She kicks ass with that thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that blade is terrifying, especially with its mind control. You can create an army with that thing, but she doesn't do anything with it. She just tries to keep it under control. Well, she is a fantastic girl, and oh god, I ship her so hard with the dollar leader.
Mikado?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, I ship them so. I have no more words for her.
Respect for da-da-da.
Yes. Absolute love that show.
It was really hard to pick one of them.
That's true. Fair. A lot of them in that show are really, really good.
Spoilers, I do have one da-da-da girl for my honorable mentions, but let's move on.
We'll move on to number four.
Mm-hmm.
So number four.
Oh.
Fuck the creator. This character needed more development, and she deserved to be with the main character by the end of it all. Lasana Strauss from Fairy Tail.
Oh.
Oh. Well, you got EDA happy.
Yes. Lasana Strauss.
I ship not.
She deserves to be with Natsu. I said it.
I'm right.
I ship Natsu with Urza, but I agree that Lasana needs more focus.
Amen.
Lasana is just a sweetheart. How can you hate that? How?
I don't know, but some people do.
Even the creator hated her and just. What a fucking moron.
There's a reason why people are King Lasana.
Oh, Lasana's your number four, huh?
Yes. Yeah. There's a reason why people don't like Lasana. Those people are the Lucy simps.
Exactly.
What has
Lucy done?
Nothing.
Tell me.
Without a keys, zip bumpkins.
I mean, Lasana.
Well, what has Lasana done, to be honest?
She's still like. She has died. She has these moments that are just like so rare in the series that she is just a treasure. Especially when she came back.
I know.
Especially when she did that.
Oh yeah, that's one thing she did, Kevin. Survived in a matchless world for 2 years.
Yes. We even mentioned this before. She looks absolutely fantastic in a wedding dress.
Yeah, man.
Natsu admits it, even though he's oblivious, he admits it.
And that's why when me and Kevin are doing our Fairy Tale Digimon story,
with
Lasana.
Bitch, are. Excuse me.
I give you some of the ideas, so.
Yes?
So, I just wish that the creator put more time in developing her rather than just a bland airhead who keeps on smacking the main character around just for stupid reasons.
I'm not making that mistake with the Pokemon Mage.
I don't think anybody with a brain is making that mistake.
And hopefully you don't ship teaser with fucking Bixlow or Loxus.
Oh, God.
Who the fuck? Not Loxus, no.
I never got
guys, let Brandon finish. Come on.
Sorry, Brandon.
I just absolutely. And plus, her magic power is pretty damn unique, if I do say so.
Well, to be fair, her brother and sister can also transform. But yeah, being a pussycat was awesome.
And just, I love her English dub voice when she did when she transformed into the cat form and did that whole meow attack. I was like,
did you just squeal?
Like Jade Saxon, you got some competition for your cat characters.
Oh, it was you, EAO, that's why.
And I just, like I said before, she needed more development. The creator should have given more time to just, rather than just the main five, and develop everyone, not just them. So yeah, Lasana is 10 times better than Lucy Artphilia. She belongs with Natsu, and she's my number four.
Yeah, also Trey, damn, but you're not wrong, though.
Why you gotta shit on Vixen?
I'm not shitting on Vixen. I'm just saying that Lasana's powers are kind of like a better version of hers.
Can Lasana use the
animal kingdom? Yeah, because once she loses that... Yes!
It's also the fact that Vixen can't... All right, my turn. Yeah. Draw. No, I'm just kidding. No. Fuck you, Nate.
Always.
Fuck you, Trey.
Is it?
Joelle's awesome. Oh, oh look.
Silva.
I get it. You guys don't like her. Mimosa's better. Yes, but can you deny that she has developed? Can you deny that?
Her development. We just hate her tsundere ass moments.
Okay, that's fine, okay? I don't like Mimosa because she's basic, okay?
Jeez.
Okay? But I respect you guys for liking Mimosa. But yeah, Noelle, yes, I admit, her tsundere tendencies are annoying, maybe on par with Rin Tosaka's. At least Rin has controlled it somewhat. But, god damn it, her backstory just... just imagine being hated by your siblings, you know, all your life, being blamed for your mother's death, which you didn't even cause, you know. It's terrifying. And just, I know, yes, she was the whole Iron Royal thing, you know, in a way she was kind of like Weiss, mm-hmm. but she grew faster, you know. And the Sea Temple arc, damn, just seeing her one true female friend just get hurt and becoming, you know, using this power and growing over time, it's great, you know? And her fights, holy shit. Like, when she used the Valkyrie Jest and the fight in the manga against that bitch in the Dark Triad.
Yeah.
Yeah. We need a rematch. I swear to God, if they fuck that up, I'm gonna be pissed.
Well, we're gonna get a rematch. Black Clover's too black and white for that. Oh shit, I just realized I made a pun.
Yeah, he did.
Anyways,
she's just a good character. All right, still, Sekire is my queen, but Noelle's a good runner up. Fuck you, EDA. You can go to hell. That's it. Go ahead, Trey.
Noelle's still alive.
I will say this.
That escalated quickly.
Wait, what?
Boy, this escalated quickly.
What did he say?
At least Noelle's still alive.
Okay, number four. Kevin brought up Food Wars, and as much as I love Alice and Erina, I'm gonna go with the purest girl ever, Megumi Tadokoro.
Oh.
Yes! Blue hairs! You can't go wrong with them!
Yeah. Honestly, the moment that Megumi showed up, I knew she was like the one for me. Like, she's the sweetest person ever. And the fact that, yeah.
The better the Mimosa.
Okay, mister, I'm salty water.
Ooh.
But anyway, but I will agree on that. Like, it pains me to admit it. She is like a bit... Megumi's a bit better
than
that one episode that made me cry. I think you know which one I'm talking about, Kevin. when she won her first unofficial food war.
No, the thing is, it was a, more of a tie, but god damn it!
Yeah, and people always seem to like not give Megumi credit because she's not as good a cook, but if you really think about it, her cooking style is very nurturing and very heartwarming as well, and it really fits her character as well. Because while some characters are usually like all the fan servicey way, Megumi is just in between. She's just very calm about it. She fumbles a lot, especially when she does.
Oh.
It was just so funny whenever she like stumbles and fumbles. It was just adorable. And as much as the dub is Mr. Hit, I will admit, I love Megumi's Japanese and English voice, and you're probably gonna love it, Brandon. Jad Saxon. That's probably my favorite role that Jack Sutton has done other than Kaneko. It's just amazing. Also, while I may not cop in season two, I did saw what happened in the season two OVA, and oh my god. The way that she was playing ping pong.
That girl's a dead, she's a dead, she may be soft when she's cooking, but in ping pong, she's a devil.
Yeah, no joke. When I saw that moment, I was like, oh shit.
Right.
And are we sure that's the same Sob and Shy Megumi? But yeah, Megumi's just adorable. I love her cooking style. She's very underrated. And I can't wait to see more of her in the later seasons. Number four.
Alrighty. Trey, what do you got for your number five?
Sorry, I think I may be cursed.
Brandon.
I think my internet likes Nate more because every time it just skips over to him.
Wait, wait a minute. Your internet's mad racist then. Wow. It goes to the Puerto Rican instead of you. Wow.
Yeah, I feel bad.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
But that's my choice. Yep, let's go into Full Metal Alchemist.
Oh, oh wait. I know who this is. I know.
Some people say Hot Guy. Some people say Lust. I say it's the better sibling of the Armstrong family, Olivier from Beaumont Alchemist's Brotherhood.
Yes!
A woman of might. Yes.
I am also now realizing I may have a fetish for women with swords and ice queens.
Hey,
God damn it. I liked her because, you know, she always made a badass impression with me, kicking her brother's ass around the mansion. was an iconic scene for me. And I just love how confident she struts around as the leader. She's like, if honestly, I think she should have been Fuhrer over Roy Mustang, in my opinion.
Aww.
Wow.
Like, I know she had no interest in the position, but I felt really that inspired by her as a leader. But she has one of the best anime kills ever. Like, she just slits a guy's throat and just tosses him into a bunch of cement. What does she stab him?
She stabs him.
Gangster shit.
Yeah. And the fact that she just cleans her blade and just throws it out, and then she's given a new pair, I'm like, dude, this girl is queen. And the fact
it was actually gloves, but
Yeah. But no, the fact that she and her brother fought Sloth.
Law.
They fought Sloth, dude. That was amazing. Trey, also, you get my respect for that.
Yeah. Also, queen. I think you mean like war goddess.
I have two war goddesses in my list then.
Oh, cool.
And they're both blonde.
So, my number four is Faye Valentine from Cowboy Bebop.
Oh, yeah. Classic.
So, of course, she is the sexual breakout character of this game. She's a pretty trustworthy member in Spike's crew, but especially when it comes down to it, when it comes to getting her goal, sometimes she will use her sexuality to seduce men, but doesn't really like it at the same time that she gets desired by people. So it's like, I mean, like, I don't know what else you, I don't know what do you want us to think, man? She's a pretty guarded person, doesn't really trust anybody, and doesn't like to stay in the same place all the time, even if she does try to remain strong. She has some vulnerabilities about her. You can obviously tell with Spike and Faye that they obviously care for one another, and it's arguably one of the most complex relationships of the series. You know, Shinichiro Watanabe said on the subject.
Hang on, stop. Sorry. Who the fuck's making that noise?
I don't know.
Sorry.
Could be a reverb effect.
Or probably audio.
Yeah.
Okay, I could continue, I'm sorry.
Okay. You know what Shinshiro Watanabe said about Spike and Faye's relationship?
What?
He says, sometimes I'm asked the question, what does Spike think of Faye? I think he likes her quite a bit, but he's not a straightforward person and makes sure not to show it. Even if there is a lot of speculation that Spike and Faye are into each other. Because you can obviously tell they care for one another. Number four is Faye Valentine.
Nice. What a classic.
Nice.
Nice, buddy. So yeah, I'm sorry. Hold on. To you. Alrighty. So, EDA, what is your number four?
Well, Eric mentioned one space girl. We're going to go to another one.
I know.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
The one from the anime that he shits on.
You don't know who I'm thinking of.
Just say it.
Twilight Suzuka from Outlaw Star.
I told you I knew it because you keep shooting on Cowboy Bebop. It's because always you're stuck in Outlaw Star's dick. So continue, please.
So continue.
This woman is an assassin, and god damn it, I can believe it. She sliced through a fucking bus with a wooden sword. And everybody thought, like, oh, well, that's some impressive magic. And then she's like, that was simply a feat of strength. Nothing enhanced her. All natural. So she walks around in a kimono. Oh, she looks freaking pretty in that. And she's funny, too. Especially when they're on that beach planet. She slaps the mascot. The head turns around and they just shove her into the changing room. And I love the character development. She started out as an enemy, slowly became an ally, and then you find out her motivation. She wants to find and kill the bastard who killed her parents. Parents. And goddammit, was the payoff worth it? Okay? She kicks major ass. I truly do not understand why this series as a whole was so underrated, but number four is Suzuka.
Nice. Okay.
That's fair. Yeah. Alrighty. Number three. So, you guys enjoy Magical Girls? Yeah, because this girl is just awesome. She's the best magical girl I have seen, and plus she knows how to rock a lot of cute different little outfits. It is Asuka from Magical Girl Spec Ops Asuka. That's right.
Yeah.
This girl is just when I first saw her in the opening of the pilot episode, I just knew that her character was going to be something that I would get behind. Someone who struggles with PTSD, who just doesn't want to deal with fight anymore, who wants to live a normal life and never wants to go back. But no matter how far you run, that life will always be with you and will always catch up with you. And it's a shame because all she wants to do is just try and leave that life behind her. And it's just heartbreaking to know that all of her friends during that war were killed grotesque and horrifyingly brutal. And basically forced to be a leader that she doesn't want to be because she doesn't trust herself. But when she does, and when she goes full power on someone in certain fights, she, like Ryuko, kicks major ass. And plus, she looks pretty damn cute in a school swimsuit and black lingerie. I'm gonna be completely honest.
Yeah.
Even some of the girls in the show,
I don't blame
simp for her, and I can see why.
Exactly. I can see why Kurame is in love with Asuka, because Asuka's
Prevention.
She's just that good, and I want a fucking season two. When?
I agree.
I mean, if I can find the manga, I'll read the manga, but there's season two, let it happen, please.
Yeah, but yeah, I want it.
Asuka is my magical girl, and she is my number three.
Oh, you had to say it like that. Huh?
Yes,
oh,
I did. Boy.
All right. All right, well, hang on. I have it right here.
Oh, no, what's he doing?
I got to clear my throat. What's he doing? Some water.
If it's phlegm, I recommend whiskey.
I think I know who it is.
Yep. What am I? A better girl than Lucy, who I feel should have been the main girl. Yeah. And God damn it, her magic to manipulate water is awesome. Juvia Luxor from Fairy Tail. Yeah. Okay. I get it. The fuck did you just say, bitch?
Oh boy.
Did he just say Sakura?
No,
John's fired.
We'll get into that later. Okay, well anyways. So this girl, when I saw the Phantom Lord arc and just hearing her say drip drip drip, I'm like, Jesus Christ, this girl's just emo. And then you learn about her backstory, how she always made it rain, even her boyfriend, who I fucking despise, because Bora can go fuck himself. Just the fact that it was always depressed, always bringing the rain. And then when Gray fights her, which was funny, but badass, it changed her life, you know? She could finally see the sun. I'm like, dude, this girl's precious. And when she joins Fairy Tail, I was like, this girl's attitude. Jesus almighty Christ. Like, this girl tugs at my heartstring. I know she's a stalker. Yeah, she can be a stalker. All right, let's not beat around the bush.
Yeah,
but God damn it, when she learns to care about Fairy Tail, she learns to care. I know he should have just fucked her from there. I know, Nicholas. But man, her magic. Okay, remember her fight against Merity when she learned that Gray's life was in danger? Even Urza was scared. Okay, if you can scare Urza, then yeah, you're just that terrifying. And my God, during Tartarus, when she killed that one member who was connected to, who's connected to Silver, and she had to kill him, even though that would kill Silver, dude. And then when she died in the Alvarez arc. Oh,
and that was the moment where Gray realized that he had feelings for her.
Finally, Gray. Yeah, and people say Natsu's dense, okay? Like Natsu's dense. Look at fucking Mr. Stripper here.
Just the bloodiest.
Exactly. Juvia is just, she's a great girl. She's a great companion. Just don't give Gray a certain look, okay? She'll kill you. But still, she's an awesome girl.
Rival. Yeah.
Rival. Hashtag rival. All right. Yeah.
All right. Who's next? Nice. Two females have already made it here.
Is it all good?
Trey.
I hope so. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
All good.
Okay. It is from a more older Guilty Pleasure series from a long time ago. Brandon knows it. I'm talking about Lala Satalin Devil Luke from Two Love Brew.
Oh, Tula Brew? The hell? Wow.
It's a romantic comedy harem anime that
literally walks the fine line of hentai.
Well, shit.
Yeah. Oh,
so, yeah. Softcore ecchi?
Okay, let me put it like this. Let me summarize it. Rito Yuki, generic harem boy. He takes a bath. Lala teleports into his bathtub and he accidentally gropes her breasts. She's an alien on their planet. Groping a woman's breast is a proposal to marriage and he's destined to become the next king of the
galaxy. Yeah.
What the fuck?
You can't make that shit up.
What fiction you are watching?
This is one of the first anime and manga I've ever seen.
That'd be an impressive impression.
I thought I was rude.
What's even funny is that it had like a total of like 5 seasons.
It was so popular. I don't know how.
Five? I think Trey just hit an existential low point.
You can. Well, in my horny 13-year-old mind, it was the greatest shit ever. Now it's just a guilty pleasure at this point. But yeah, Lala, I like her because she's one of those like ditzy, kind-hearted, cute girls that's like always happy and shit like that. But she's also the smartest person in the galaxy. I don't. That's a contradiction. Like, she's constantly making inventions. She even made her own little hyper subspace where you can literally put plants and animals in and breed. It's like a fucking zoo.
I kind of want to watch this now.
And what's funny is that she actually like she acts like a airhead half the time.
Yeah, me too.
You're not smart.
Okay, this is definitely
so
stuff I heard.
But she's so nice. She has 2 younger sisters that she takes care of. Although Rito's kind of generic, for his birthday, she traveled to another alien planet and took an indigenous plant from its environment and planted it in his backyard because he likes gardening.
Aww.
And after that, she ended up getting like a fatal infection afterwards, but she doesn't regret her decision at all.
Oh my god, this is waifu material.
Yeah.
I know, right? Cool. And you want to know something else, though? You want to know how loyal this chick is? She tries to call off the marriage and erase his memories of ever meeting her so she can be with the person that he had a crush on before he ever met her.
Damn. Okay, dude, I'm watching this tomorrow. God. I'm watching. Holy
But then after that, when he finally confesses to her, she understands that he still has feelings for the other girl he had a crush on. She's like, take your time. I'll wait as long as I need to.
Dude.
She's patient.
Dude, this is not...
That is prime material.
No, that's not wife material. That's god wife material.
It is god wife material because Rito is the most fucking indecisive piece of shit on the fucking planet.
Okay, Trey. Okay, guys.
I'm sorry, you're pissing me off because after that confession, guess what? They don't do jack shit. They don't even go on a date. They don't even have a first kiss. She tries to kiss him. He just freaks out like a little bitch and runs away. And you know what after that? She says, just keep taking your time. I'll keep waiting with a fucking smile on her face when she deserves better. God damn it.
Indeed.
I'm gonna
God tier wife. I mean, I really like Yami. I actually like Yami in that show too. She's also really cool, but
I think Yami's the best
sweetheart.
I think Yami's the best character, but Lala is easily waifu, big sis, inventor girl. What she's just all around the best in life.
Hey, blondes, you gotta love them. All right, go ahead, Nate.
All right, Nate.
Okay, on the topic of blondes, and here's a question. What will happen if Noelle Silva grows up? Well, here's the answer to that. My second best girl, Charlotte Rosalie.
From Black Clover, yep.
Ooh.
He is not wrong.
You're not wrong there.
Yeah, honestly, she's one of my favorite captains in this series. And also, this is a bit of an interesting trivia fact. Eric, you remember when you said that you and Yukiko from Persona 4 shared the same birthday?
Yeah.
Me and Charlotte shared the same birthday, September 18.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Only a week after 9/11.
Aww.
Eric.
Sorry. Okay. In my defense, I usually use little patterns like that so I can remember certain details. For instance, one of my friends has the same birthday as the voice actress for Fa Mulan.
Oh, nice.
So that's how I remember her birthday.
Okay, but on to Charlotte.
Please do.
Sorry.
Honestly, she is cursed. Like, her powers go out of control to the point that it sealed away her parents. and the only way for it to break is that if she were to fall in love. Yeah, it's cliche, but you can actually understand why she wouldn't do it. She just wants to free her family and just want to have a normal life, but no, her curse prevents it. It wasn't until she met Yami that's when everything changed.
Sorry, Nate. Is Charlotte a Beauty and the Beast reference?
Holy shit!
Yes, she is! Yes, it is.
Conspiracy theorists, bitches!
How did you guys wait this long to figure it out? It took me 2 seconds.
I'm slow, man.
We're idiots. Yeah.
More onto Charlotte. Like, while she may appear like stoic and very mature and a little bit mean sometimes, she does have some level of honor as a night captain. And she is very... I think that's like one problem that I have with like Noelle. The fact that she isn't like fully honest. While I can understand it, I think in comparison, Charlotte's a little bit more honest if you think about it. Because like literally whenever she confronts Yami, instead of slapping him and getting mad at him, she just runs away.
Well, the thing is, if you slap Yami, you're going to die.
Yeah. Yeah, but on the topic of running, that was hilarious.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Especially the second time where Yami's like,
she took my baby!
Yet that, and also, seriously, this again, you're toying with my emotions.
Yami's such a troll.
Yeah, he's just waiting for Charlotte to confess.
Wait a minute. Imagine if Yami raised Soma to be a troll, like him.
That would explain it.
Okay.
Another thing that I love about Charlotte is her magic.
All of
Briar magic is just amazing. She could go practical with it and offensive with it. And oh my god, Briar Queen. Freaking Briar Queen.
What?
Honestly, as much as enjoyable as that Noelle and the Heart Queen fight is with that one female triad member, the fact that Charlotte was able to apprehend her quickly, I was like, oh shit. You don't mess with them. But earn that title.
Yes, but you gotta remember, that was human form.
I know.
Which has me worried.
I know. And the last thing I gotta say about Charlotte, this Colleen Klinkenbeer, that is, honestly, her role as Charlotte is my second favorite, right behind Urza. That's all I can say about her. Number three.
Fair enough. Eric?
All right. Number one.
No, three.
No, I was going to say, well, hold on. Number one, an episode showed up yesterday. Number two.
Yu-Gi-Oh!
What?
Number three is Alexis Rhodes from GX.
Yay!
You see what I did there, Kevin?
It was on your album. That was on your last list, huh?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Eric's lazy, guys.
She's so good, you gotta say it twice.
Sorry.
He had to come up twice.
Wait till you see what's higher up the list. You'll be further surprised.
Okay.
It's both hands.
Okay, so what can I really say about Alexis? She honestly kinda sticks out more than Taya Gardner, honestly.
No, you think? Statement.
And she actually like contributes like heavily to the plot and has like an ex.
Oh, Trey, what have you done?
Fuck's sake! Don't blame this on me.
He transferred the curse.
So similarly to Akane in GX, a lot of guys are simping over Alexis.
Who wouldn't? Yeah,
fair point. Well, I mean. Then again, I'd probably only simp over her mostly for the fact that, okay, well, while she's attractive and everything, she's also pretty intelligent and knows how to duel like a real pro. True. Even though her relationship, through her relationship with her brother, who, by the way, also uses
red eyes.
She used to lose back then, but now she's like a total winner.
Winner,
especially
in more ways than one, actually.
Especially in Arc B, man, her Cyber Angel deck.
Oh, man.
She had the Cyber Angel deck in the GX also. It's just that's I kind of wish that in Arc V, she had a more, it was more the continuation of her, not just
exactly. It's like,
come on, that could have been the perfect opportunity to bring characters together from different Yu-Gi-Oh eras.
True. All right, well, damn, Eric, you get a snap from me. Yeah, nice.
But anywho, also when I found out that, well, also when she had like a crush on Jaden and she never got to tell him in episode 162, but she decides not to and insists that she's just glad to have met him. I'm just like, God damn it, Jaden. You fucking idiot.
That's every single Yu-Gi-Oh thing besides fucking Zexal to do it.
Yeah, what?
Let's
move on, yeah.
Anywho, so number three is Alexis Rhodes.
Yeah.
All right, EVA. What is your number three?
Unless you're going to lag.
Number three.
Oh,
final tie, ladies and gentlemen.
Yay. Yeah.
Well, Kevin, you actually mentioned one of them earlier.
What?
Juvia.
Oh.
Oh, shit.
Wait, was Juvia your number three too, Kevin?
Oh, yes.
Who's the other one?
You guys might be surprised by this, but I actually like Minerva as well.
Minerva?
Oh, fuck me. What the fuck?
Yeah, you know what?
The fuck?
All right, I'm out.
Hello?
Don't rage quit.
EA?
Yeah?
EA, between this and Raven, you have lost all right to shit-talking anyone else's best girls. You know that, right?
I will say this.
Oh, wait.
Minerva is a little more likable than that piece of shit father of hers.
That's an understatement.
I don't want much.
Listen, okay, look. What else like can I say magic about Yumi?
All right.
Yeah, she is amazing. Oh. And Gray's a fucking idiot for not getting with her sooner. But here's the reason I like. So let's talk about Minerva, okay? Because
I hope we don't.
Here's the thing. She has Lucy's backstory, but she does it right. Gemma is actually a piece of shit father, unlike Jude, who we really didn't see do anything bad. I mean, what was the worst thing we saw from him? One time yelling.
He hired Phantom Lord. That's the extent of
that's just it. Nothing else.
Yeah. Gemma, he's not just a piece of shit to Minerva. He's a piece of shit to everybody. I mean, do you want me to go through what he did to Minerva as a
child? Please, no. Please don't. I don't have time.
All right. And here's another thing. She had more character growth in the few episodes she was in than most of the cast.
Oh, that's true.
Which is a goddamn shame, considering she's not even in the titular guild.
Stop repeating.
And she was scary a couple of times, but she definitely softened up. And I just love that magic. Controlling space and time. Controlling space. Where the fuck did time come from?
Pokemon.
Yeah, that's my... Whatever. That's my final tie.
Also, let's say this. She did apologize to Lucy.
Yeah.
Okay?
Right, which is more than a lot of the villains in this series that show have done.
True. Okay, go ahead, Brandy.
Number two.
Brandy.
We got a brand new opening for this anime.
Oh, wait, I know who this is.
There it is.
Yep. The best girl in Yashahime, fight me. Setsuna Higurashi from Yashahime, Princess Half Demon.
Oh. Well, technically, she doesn't have a last name. That's the thing. She's not Higurashi. She's technically just Setsuna.
Yeah, well, wow.
I'm giving her the last name, so fuck it.
No.
Brandon bringing in the twins.
Oh shit, Nicholas left.
I think you have to log out.
I knew a lot of characters. Once episode 2 and 3 came around for Yashihime with Setsuna, I'm just... She is by far the best girl. The story behind her, the backstory, and plus, she can play the violin like a pro.
Beautiful. I agree.
Love that.
Yo-Yo Ma in this house.
So, also, fun fact, that's Rin's theme from Inuyasha she's playing.
It's absolutely beautiful. And I am also just... I love her fighting style. I really do. She uses a lot of different combinations in long range, and when she gets up close to that spear, she knows how to use that thing.
Mm-hmm.
And when we saw her demon form,
that was awesome, I will admit.
That was insane, honestly. Yes.
Further solidified my point.
Also, one thing I gotta love, how Setsuna is usually like the serious one that doesn't want to get involved in Morha and Toa shenanigans.
Yeah.
In a way, she's kind of like Blake, but better.
But it's also like with the most recent episode as well. She doesn't know what a cell phone was. I tried to slice it.
He must die. He must die.
And plus the newest opening just focuses on the sisters, like what is gonna happen in this part. I am taking all bets that we are gonna get the reveal, and she will get her memories back. While Toa might actually feel something else when she unleashes that power in her.
I hope.
Taking all bets.
Hell yeah.
I'm going there skeptically, just so I won't get my hopes ruined.
Plus, yeah, like with Ruby.
Plus when we saw the all three of them in the modern day era, Setsuna rocks that dress.
I agree. I fucking agree.
Oh, hell yeah. Right.
Also, the dream outfit that she had during Toa's dream. Nice.
Oh, that's true. Oh, yeah, Nicholas, are you still having trouble with the best waifu for Yashihime?
Yes.
Son of a bitch, choose Setsuna!
Your turn, Kevin.
Who's the best girl? Because all three of them are good. I'm banking on that Morha and Toa will get more episodes too.
I hope, because Morha deserves it.
So yes, Setsuna, to me, is the best girl of Yashihime. She had to go on like number two.
Dude, that's awesome.
Oh, man. What do you got for number two?
Another tie.
Oh, your last tie.
And no, this is actually not my last tie.
Oh, this is your second tie. Right?
Yeah, so magical girls. They're badass. Brandon mentioned one, Asuka. But let's mention her teammate, the American sniper, Mia Cyrus. Come on, am I wrong, Brandon? She uses a sniper and she's American.
Okay. Tell us why you like Hannah Montana on Call of Duty.
No, Brent, that's literally her reference to her name. Mia Cyrus is Miley Cyrus, and Mia's from Texas, okay? Trey, that is on point. And goddamn it, Nate. Okay, so Asuka, I'll just go quick with her. Eric Brennan, what the fuck is going on?
Mute yourselves.
I don't think they can. Oh, these fucking idiots. All right. So Asuka, Brandon, you didn't mention her fighting with her knife. You didn't mention how skilled she is. Like, Trey, she's one of the slickest knife users. And when she uses her magic calorie with her sword, dude. And plus, goddammit, Asuka, just like, her leadership's badass and her outfit, Rapture, just... Oh my god, I need her more of her... Now let's go to Mia. She's literally an American sniper. Like, She's now a mercenary in the U.S. Army because she wants to make money. That's what she does after the war. It's just, it's funny. You know, you expect them like, oh, we'll serve our country. No, she just wants to get money. That's funny, you know? And her magic, okay, first of all, her outfit. Yes. Like, it's a big thumbs up from me. And the fact that her gun can transform to anything from a silenced pistol to a machine gun to a sniper, yes. And I love how, despite fighting a terrorist, when she loses her parents in a terrorist attack, she sympathizes with them. She tries to understand them. And yet she still kills them no matter what, because it's her job. It's just... And, dude, when I saw her get hurt during the second half of the season, I got scared. I was like, don't kill Mia. God damn it. And the fact that she was in a relationship with the past leader who groped her, I'm like, holy shit, this is hilarious. I love her dynamic with Tamara, the American, and the Rescue. Yeah. What a pair, you know? So yeah, that's my second tie for this video.
Yeah,
oh, Trey, fucking hate you.
What the hell, Trey?
He's not wrong.
Miley Cyrus.
Her name is Mia Cyrus, so it makes sense. And like I said, she's from Texas.
And she's blonde, so yeah.
Exactly. Nice
connection. Yep. So
only difference is Mia is a natural blonde.
And she's better.
Even though don't know.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead, Trey. Trey, go.
Okay. Best demon girl barmaid in fairy tale. Mary Jane Strauss.
What?
Oh!
Wait a minute. Brandon brought up the little sister, and now you bring... God damn it, guys.
What's with the sibling thing? What?
I have a taste, apparently. But moving on from that, I prefer Urza as a character, but I love Mary Jane in a sense that I would definitely see myself wanting to be with her. You know, like, although she went through her... goth phase when she was younger, she really did mature after Lizanna's quote-unquote death. And although the trauma did have a negative impact, okay, anyways, when she finally unveiled in Soul, it was a badass scene, one of my favorite moments in Fairy Tail, and I love each of her following forms after that. You have Seatree, Halfa, that was when that just shows the potential of demon takeover right there. And it's a goddamn shame that she didn't get more of a spotlight. Like, because she's literally Urza's rival. Like, what the fuck? Why doesn't she get more of a spotlight?
I agree.
Ken, fixing that problem in my fanfic.
Saying, why are we fixing everything in our fanfics? Like, this is ridiculous.
Because the guy is not as lazy as hell to him because it's bunch of bullshit.
And yet he does it better in the sequel, but that
and it pisses me off. Like, although she can rock a swimsuit. Yeah. Like, even though she can rock a swimsuit like nobody's business, why was that her match in the festival? She could have had a time, real moment to really show how to kick ass fight. Like, I love Seatree though. So I love how she curb stomped Jenny with Seatree, but still, come on.
Yeah, I would have loved to see that book.
Alright, yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, Mary Jane Strauss, she's my number two.
Alrighty.
Number two. For sake of moving on before I lag out.
Yeah. Alright, go Nate.
Okay, this is my last tie, and...
Nice.
I think Brandon and Eric are going to mention him when I said one of these characters, Kyoko Kirigiri from Danganronpa. Yep. And tie with her, this is my best girl in Persona 4, Naoto Shirogane.
Oh-hoo-hoo!
The cross-dresser?
Yep.
Apparently.
Okay.
Wow. Oh boy, you're good, Brandon.
No, he's genuinely curious. Keep going. Come on, we're okay. Wasting time.
I'm a little too curious.
All right, let me talk about Kyoko first. Yeah, I thought I might make this clear. I love detectives. They're like one of my favorite kinds of characters in all of media. And seeing Kyoko embodies the ultimate detective title, it's just beautiful. And I can't believe you two didn't even mention her backstory in the previous videos. It's sad. Literally. Her grandfather forced her to become the ultimate detective to the point that where she can't even see her own mom's funeral. Like, what the hell? That is messed up.
That bastard.
I know. But it was thanks to that training she actually developed like her own intellect. Even if it means that she does have a hard time expressing her emotions. It wasn't until the High Peaks of Pat Academy arc. Nah, I'm just speaking gibberish at this point. It wasn't until she met like the main character that she started to express her feelings a bit more. Sure, she remains stoic and all that, but she does have her quirky and funny moments. And she's very crucial to the story, helping out the main character survive every incident and helping out every other characters with her intellect. And yes, I agree. Her time skip outfit is just amazing. Nice. I don't think I got anything else to add for it, except the voice actors for the video game and the anime did a great job for it. But I think that's enough about Kyoko. Let's talk about Naoto.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, who is ironically the first detective prince way before Akechi. And like Toa, I did thought Naoto was a boy until I realized that she was a girl the whole time. Yeah.
That was fucking insane.
I know. But the reason why she kind of looks like a dresses up as a boy is because like the society was kind of a bit harsh on the genders in terms of like the work she was there. But regardless, she still works hard. She earns that title of Detective Prince. It was just amazing. And when she joined the party, she also became like a good guy for them. Always giving them good advice. And not gonna lie, when they were like getting drunk, now it's just like, you guys aren't drunk. I just died of laughter during that scene. It was just hilarious. Also, I gotta point this out. Best OTP in Persona 4, Kanji and Naoto.
Even though people think Naoto's a girl, or a guy, so yeah. They assume that Kanji's gay.
Yeah, well, Kanji may be bisexual, but cool. Who knows?
All right.
Overall, I just love how calm Naoto is. She does have her funny and quirky moments. She's very reliable, and she knows how to use the freaking pistol, especially in like the fighting games. This is amazing. Also, I have to point this out, the funny Kanji and Naoto moment. Aren't you the least bit curious, Kanji? About what? Naoto, big melons or not? What? Why are you asking me? I wasn't staring at her.
That was just comical. Eric.
Yeah, that's my number two, the two best detective girls.
Okay, so my number two is Persona 5's Anne Takamaki.
Ooh. Mother.
Whoa. Again?
Come on!
Yusuke, draw me like one of your French girls!
So yeah, I put her further on the list this time. Because, like, she's a little bit more of a fleshed out character when you realize that part of the reason she seems isolated and maybe reserved a little bit. And also more grounded morally is because, well, part of her isolation comes from the fact that she... that a lot of guys, like, well, they simp for her because, well, she's attractive. I mean, she's a model for crying out loud. Yeah, she's exactly, and even to the point where, like, what was it? When Yusuke asked if he can like draw her nude or shit, she's like, "What the fuck?"
"It's Yusuke, draw me like one of your French girls." You gotta make that joke, man. Come on, that's amazing. That was amazing.
Enough with it.
Let's not beat that dead horse. I figured I'd talk a little bit more about what I wasn't able to talk about last time about her, which is why I put her further up on the list. She's also a very compassionate person and actually sticks up for what's right. She's basically the moral center of the Phantom Thieves group.
True.
So that's my number two and enclosure on Anne Takamaki.
Nice.
Alrighty. Also, her persona is pretty cool. Even though it's hot.
Dance, Carmen!
Okay, oh, Nicholas.
Oh.
The fuck? Cornico?
Michelle K. Davis from Terraformers.
Oh man, Brandon.
Okay, well, Brandon.exe stopped working.
Are you gonna walk away?
I am just wrapping my head around that one.
I never watched Terraformers, now I'm kind of curious.
I want to know where he's going with this.
Oh, you absolutely should.
No, I won't.
Kevin, I'm not. Kevin, if you ever do watch it, just be prepared to...
Oh,
there's a lot.
She is buff.
There's a lot,
Jack. She is buff as fuck.
Yeah,
wait,
man,
what?
She is.
Yes, she is.
Continue, please.
She is bad freaking ass. Okay? Like Sue, she has the power of an animal. Only this time it's an ant. A blaster ant, which means she can blow up her enemies after one punch. Because of biology. What? That is awesome. I think Nate just found her picture.
Yep.
I did, and yeah, she could be Maki Spotter at the gym.
I know!
Okay, now I'm interested in this show.
Continue.
Yes, you should absolutely watch it.
Yeah.
Her father was one of the original... Let me start again. She's blonde, she's badass, and she will kick your ass in a fight. I don't care who you are, if you don't respect her, she will crush your balls. And God, she's, even without her powers, she is amazing. One bug, long story, he basically dragged her underwater. She didn't panic. She stayed calm, locked in a figure four leg lock, and broke its legs just to kill it. Okay, she was willing to die to take that monster out.
Wow.
And I really, really hope she gets together with the main character. They are just adorable. To me, they are the perfect match. Okay, the sub end of her voice is awesome. That's my number two.
Wow.
Wow.
That was a genuine shock for Brandon.
Wow.
Okay.
Well, to be fair, most of the girls on that show end up dead, so...
Oh,
really wasn't that
hell.
Hard to pick her.
They pulled in a comic got killed?
They pulled like a lot of stuff like that.
Okay, well, all right, let's go to...
Let's go on to honorable mentions.
Oh boy.
Oh boy. Let's see like who's gonna be raised in the comments because we didn't put them on the list. Alrighty, so my first honorable mention goes to Saber Red from Fate Extra.
Tewa Higurashi, Yashihime Princess Half Demon.
Mimosa Vermilion from Black Clover.
Mimosa Vermilion, Black Clover.
Yukiko Amagi, Persona 4.
Yukiko, Persona 4.
Asuna Yuki, Sword Art Online.
Shinobu from Demon Slayer.
Akiko Yoshino, Bungo Stray Dogs.
Noi from Dorohedoro.
Mee Connery from Scientific Railgun.
Mikasa Ackerman, Attack on Titan.
Mikasa Ackerman from Attack on Titan.
Noelle Nishan from Burn the Witch.
Saris Victoria Helsing.
Anna Alberona from Fairy Tail.
Mizure Shiryuki, Rosary and a Vampire.
Tamara Volkova, Magical Girl Spec Ops Asuka.
Tamara Magical Girl Spike Off Asuka.
Maki Oze from Fire Force.
Kagome from Inuyasha.
Aisha Clan Clan, Outlaw Star.
Akino Himajima from DXD.
Raftalia, Rising of the Shield Hero.
Chiel from Akame Ga Kill.
Momo Yayorozu from My Hero Academia.
Coco Adol from Ruby.
Elizabeth Mabley from Freezing.
Ryo Futaba from Rascal Does Not Dream of Bunny Girl Senpai.
Kaneko Tojo from High School DxD.
Shura from Blue Exorcist.
High Elf Archer, Goblin Slayer.
Waishni Ruby.
Sayako Busujima, High School of the Dead.
Nabero Gamma from Overlord.
Nora Valkyrie, Ruby.
Alexis Rhodes, Yu-Gi-Oh! GX.
Alexis Rose from Yu-Gi-Oh! GX.
Android 18 from Dragon Ball Z, Dragon Ball Super, and Dragon Ball GT.
Flare Corona, Fairy Tail.
Mira Jane Strice, Fairy Tail.
Futaba Sakura, Persona 5.
Candace from Pokemon Diamond, Pearl, and Platinum.
Valmet from Jormungandr.
Chika Fujiwara from Kaguya-sama Love is War.
Nobara Kugisaki, Jujutsu Kaisen.
Tsubaki from Soul Eater.
Morgiana from the Baki series.
Shion from That Time I Got Reincarnated as a Slime.
Erina from Food Wars.
Verona from Dudadada.
Kali Belladonna from Ruby.
Amari from Pokemon Demon School in Raccoon.
Sailor Mars from Sailor Moon.
Mitsuki Bakugo, My Hero Academia.
Origami Tobichi from Date Alive. Alright, so the last one. Last one.
Hold on.
Uh-oh.
Oh, he's faking it. I know he is.
What? Wait, what's he putting? I think I know what his number one is.
From Persona 5. Makoto Nejima.
Yeah! What, you thought it was going to be Joker? What the hell, Trey?
No. For a second, I thought it was going to be on.
Honestly, I love how she was my number one for video games, and now it was number one for Brandon for this one.
Oh, that's funny.
What can I say? Persona 5, she is the literal queen of Persona 5. And I absolutely love her character. And yes, we do know that An is a little bit more fleshed out. She's not trying to be a bitch like Makoto was in the first when you first meet her. But when you get to know her, when you go out with dates with her, and it's just so hard being her. No matter how many times I play the game, I always end up falling for Makoto just because of the idea that she has to go through all this. Being forced to spy on you, being able to do this and that. Plus, her persona. It's a fucking motorcycle, for God's sake.
Vroom vroom, motherfuckers.
But, all, oh my God. But also, it's also when they, when that persona is leveled up, it looks like a flipping transformer.
It does.
Persona robot meets.
I just love, even the anime got her character right, and I just it's why I want to do a cosplay of Joker for this year Anime Expo, because I just love this game so much. I love the characters, I love the story. Just, I know Persona is full of life. It was every single girl's best girl. We all know that. It's Persona. But Makoto is the literal definition of queen. And that she takes the crown at number one.
Yeah. Also, can't wait to see her in Strikers. And I already saw her outfit. It's good.
It is awesome.
Oh, boy. Oh, you dirty bastards. All right. I already said this, but for my number one, surprisingly, it's a tie. When science and magic collide, a story is born. In this case, there are two stories, okay? From a certain magical index, Kaori Kanzaki, the priestess, and from a certain scientific accelerator, the necromancer, Esther Rosenthal. Oh, it's, Brendan, it was tough, okay? Don't judge me. Okay. Dude, how do you expect me to choose between these two? All right? Let me start with Kaori. She's literally Urza in this series. She is a sword-wielding, wire-using, motherfucking badass. I mean, she beat Toma, and dudes, like, she could fight an army, all right? Her outfit, it might look weird, but god damn it, she makes it work. And Jesus Christ, the Well, to be fair, Eric, yes, one of the girls is a necromancer, okay? She's brought people back. I'll explain more later. But yeah, just the thing about Kanzaki, she hates the mention of good luck because she is a priestess and she is known to be, you know, the beacon of good luck. Thing is, she feels that she's taking everyone's good luck away being around them. So she hates talking about luck. But goddamn, like, she does try to be a good person. She tries to help people. And the fact she could fight in space? I don't know how, but it works. As for Esther, yes, she's a necromancer. Yes, she brings people back from the dead. But she regrets it. She wants people to have proper deaths. And god damn it, her story, like when we see a little backstory from her, I wanted to cry because god damn it, she made a promise and she couldn't even keep it because she fucked up. It's just like in the end of the Accelerator series, just like she stopped being a freaking necromancer. She just wanted to stop. I love how she keeps calling Accelerator her master, even though he's like, get the fuck away from me, because he's no hero. And the thing about these two girls, they can't use technology for shit. Kanzaki can't even use a washing machine without freaking out. And Esther, she goes to a restaurant, she doesn't even know what anything is, because it's so random. I just love these two girls. They're just badass and adorable. I just need more of them. All right.
But what? Can I just mention the best part of Kaori? The Fallen Angel sexy maid cosplay.
Yes. Oh, yeah. She doesn't want to wear that outfit, right?
It's so embarrassing. Get right. Usually wears.
Oh, boy. Okay, number one. It was mentioned a few times, and yes, I agree. She should have been the main character. My second best girl in Fairy Tail, Juvia Loxer.
Yeah. Oh my god, yes.
Honestly, she just sold it for me. She's, Yeah, she was an emo during the beginning, but like Kevin mentioned, her backstory is sad. Just like Charlotte, she's cursed to have it rain constantly. Can you imagine how bad that must have been? Everybody pushed her away because of that. And while she did join Venom Lord, she was only used as a weapon thanks to the Guildmaster. It wasn't until her battle with Grey that her world started to open. The rain stopped. And on top of that, she joined Fairy Tail. And if you really think about it, she's on good terms with him. And remember how I mentioned in a previous video that there's a good way to do a simp and a bad way to do it? Juvia's the good way to do a simp. Literally, like, she's head over heels for Grey, but that is not her only character trait.
Didn't she try to drug him once, though?
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, I think the one moment that I appreciated, like, Juvia way more is, like, during the Battle of Fairy Tail arc, where she and Connor were trapped in a corner, and you know how, like, the only way for the barrier to drop is either one falls in a fight? Juvia doesn't fight Connor. Instead, she skyrocketed up and takes out a Thunder Lacrima. She literally sacrificed herself to help Connor. That is dedication. That act alone proves her worth for being a Fairy Tail. And my god, her uses a water magic. She can use it from like the cold water, but she can also make it boiling hot to the point that Grey can't even stand it. It's just scary how deadly Juvia can be as a water mage. Holy cow. Especially during the Tender Island arc, and it was so crazy to see her snap. But at the same time, her quirkiness is actually kind of funny, and it never got annoying to me. And also, she shares the same voice actors as Sutton from Scientific Railgun, Brina Palencia. The Japanese voice also did a good job, too. And my god, again, I wish she was the main character for Fairy Tail instead of Lucy. So much. Yeah, I know. That's why Juvia is my number one for me.
Alrighty, Eric. Who's your new number one?
Alright, let me ask you this, guys, this one question. Is anime an animation style or a genre or both? This is the one tie I'm using from Hayao Miyazaki himself, Sophie from Howl's Moving Castle, and San from Princess Mononoke.
Oh,
I grew up with the first set of anime I grew up with as a kid was Hayao Miyazaki, man.
Oh,
and to this day, Studio Ghibli's roster of heroines, they pretty much set the bar for for how to write a female character. Sophie's arc is pretty much one of self-actualization. She starts off like plain and kind of insecure about how to kind of be a lady, and then when the Witch of the Ways curses her to look like an old lady, that's when like Sophie's kind of like, what is this? So then she gets like, she's like, and then when she starts going on this journey, getting out of society, and then, well, walking into Howl's Moving Castle, she starts to have like less preconceptions about how to be pretty or a lady. Then when she becomes like more at peace with herself, she starts to appreciate herself more. It's like she naturally starts to de-age on her own. Plus, I like her better with silver hair.
Yeah, that was kind of cute.
And then of course we got to print. So her arc of self-actualization was like the best in that movie. Then we get to San or Princess Mononoke. She's kind of a little hard to swallow at first. I mean, she kind of identifies as a wolf. So I don't know if Ashitaka kind of identifies as a furry. Okay, but she grew up as a warrior among the wolf gods. So of course she identifies as a wolf, and she's been trying to defend the forest from like the industrialization of humanity for a long time. But then when she starts to develop this relationship with Ashitaka, she starts to have like a more balanced view on things the way Ashitaka does. So those are my number ones.
Wow, I didn't think we were going to get Studio Ghibli. In fact, I can't believe it took us this long to talk about it.
Agreed, man.
I know, right?
Yeah. Trey, is it working for you now?
It is, but still, just save me for last. EDA, go.
That's fair.
Okay.
All right, EDA, what is your number one?
A cold flame envelops the world. Black flower bloom. Synchro shotgun. Come forth. Black Rose Dragon, Akiza Izinski is number one.
Akiza.
Oh my god. Respect.
Yes.
I have to apologize for not putting any Yu-Gi-Oh! Girls on my first list. Okay?
It's fine. I'm
totally blanked on them. Akiza is fantastic. It's a fantastic. Her backstory is tragic. She's smart with cards and with most of life. And the interactions with you say, my god. Oh, they're so adorable. After they become friends, of course. Because before that, they were pretty lethal. Okay.
Lethal doesn't begin to describe it.
That's on. I know. And also, fuck Saya for messing with her head. Okay? Let's get that out of the way. Oh, and the fact that she wants to be her turbo dueling outfit.
I know.
Okay? Yeah. Way better in the sub than in the dub. Let's just leave it at that. And the final episode. The final episode. When she decides to become a doctor to save lives and take care of people. When all in the past, all she cared about was herself. That is fucking character growth. But it still pisses me off that they didn't just fucking confess. I would give any amount of money to see that version of the ending. Okay? Yeah. Let's just get that out of the way. That should have happened, and she should have gotten more duels. And I gotta be honest, when I picked this girl, her, I did not expect when I came out this week. She's finally getting an upgrade to the Black Rose Dragon.
Yep. Yeah, she is.
That one?
We are getting Blood Rose Dragon.
Oh my god.
And a Blood Rose Dragon. If that had come out during 5Ds, we might have gotten more jewels from her. I really hope so.
Yeah, honestly, EDA, I know you don't really pay attention to my fanfic Power Rangers Astrotron, but I do plan on incorporating that for my story since Akiza is the Pink Ranger from my story.
That's not why I'm not paying attention to it, but moving on.
Yeah, no.
I haven't even touched on its powers yet, because that's how critical they are to her as a character. But you two and Kevin went into plenty of detail with her on the last video, so I'm leaving it right there. Yeah. Still, number one for me, Akiza and Zinski.
Bravo, man.
Yes. Alrighty, Trey, wrap up this crazy video. The number one, buddy.
All right, I'm going to get straight to the point because we're all tired and I don't want to lag out again. My number one is Nico Robin from One Piece.
Oh! Oh, boy.
And trust
again. Again, Brandon.
Me and Brandon are pissed, but for different reasons.
Oh boy, yeah, continue, Trey.
All right. I love her as a character because, like Eric mentioned, she's easily the most mature person in the group, but she also has her own little bit of quirks to her, especially with how passive she is to almost literally everything that happens in the Straw Hats. One of the things I like most about it that really shows this is how she's so casual about everything. She can even casually mention, like, death in the most jarring way possible. For example, let's say Luffy is fishing on the rail of their ship, and she just says, "Careful, don't fall in, or else you'll fall over into the ocean and a shark will eat your corpse." It just comes out of nowhere, and who does that? And I also, her backstory is one of the most emotional backstories I've actually ever seen. Like, she, as a child, the day she finally met her mother for the first time was the day her entire island and home was destroyed completely by the Marines and the world government. And that entire incident ended up getting pinned on her. Like, ever since she was a child, she had a near 80 million amount of money over her head as a bounty. And every person she went to after that either A, kicked her out because she was a freak or they thought she was too dangerous, or B, they wanted to collect on a bounty themselves. So it was like a constant struggle between being abandoned or manipulated, and which is why it was so touching when Luffy, the first person that genuinely actually saved her life and gave her a place where she could be a family, when she screamed out her desire to live in CP9, it was fantastic, and I am glad she became a permanent addition to the crew from that point on. Plus, I love world history to an extreme extent, so her being an archaeologist just hits on another level to me. Also, she can make clones. I have to mention that. Out of all respect for Kevin's perversion, she makes clones.
Also, funny thing, and this might be a bit painful, but am I the only one that cringed when she convinced Frankie to join? That hurts. Oh.
I think she was slowly squeezing.
Yeah, that makes it even worse.
Well, anyways, guys, thank you for joining us on this very, very technical, difficult video. This was a nightmare. It's going to be a nightmare for me in editing. So, anyways, guys, we may be busy next week, but I'm just going to announce the next video. Next video that we're going to do is top 10 anime powers we wish we had.
Mm-hmm.
This was supposed to be the Christmas Eve special, but we wanted to spend time with our family, so we decided not to do it. So we're going to do one last anime top 10 list before we take a break. Then we go to different top 10s. So remember to smash the like button in the face, like the badasses you are, and don't forget to click subscribe and join us here in the shadows. I'm the Dark Viewer, we're the guys in the shadows, and we'll tell you about our favorite powers of anime in the next video. Peace!